to this week's episode of the Sons of Serizawa podcast. It is late when we're recording this, so we apologize for any discrepancies in our voices or fucking lapses in judgment or memory or morality
or lack of technology in some cases.
Yeah, we're about to get into that. Technical difficulties as well.
Is there like a rat chewing on your phone, Andres? Because that's what it sounded like a second ago. It was weird. There was like a noise. I heard a noise.
So as Dylan has spoiled for the audience, Andres is using his cell phone tonight to record.
Oh, is that a big reveal we were building up to? The fact that he was on his phone?
It was good. Dylan, did you see 10 Cloverfield Lane? No, you didn't. I did. So I know how to fucking build a reveal. You know how to build?
Oh, okay.
Jack shit. Jack and shit. You put it together, that's what you know how to build. I'm sorry, Dylan. That was really mean.
Why you gotta be so mean, Bill?
I don't know. I was.
What are you, some kind of asshole?
I don't know where that came from.
Oh, I don't think you're a good person at all, Bill.
No, I don't think so either. I don't think there was ever any mystery about that either. I think that was always
There was never a moment.
I was always pretty cut and dry about that.
There was never a moment where, like, Clara, am I a good person?
No, I never turned to a young 20-something girl and asked her, was I a good person? Because every 20-something girl that I've ever met or been close to enough to ask that question, I already know the answer. And it's not what Peter Capaldi wants to hear. It's not, you try. All right. So, yeah, we're doing the podcast, and I haven't introduced you guys yet. It's already fucking falling off the rails. All right, I have...
Were there any rails to begin with, Bill?
No, at this point, we're just a train driving on sand. All right, Dylan McCandless, a.k.a. Super DM 64.
Not sure that a train can drive on sand, Bill.
That's exactly the point.
I think it would just sink.
But if it's got enough momentum built, anyway. Andres Perez,
it needs a track. That's kind of...
No, but what if it fell off the tracks and went onto the sand? In theory, we started off on rails. Maybe we started briefly on rails. We built up the momentum from that, and now we're just kind of coasting on sand. But at this point, we're definitely sinking. I mean, did you listen to that drunk commentary, Dylan?
I've never had rails.
I have.
Rails are a myth.
It hurts, man. So yeah, Andres is here. Hi, Andres.
Happy Golden Week, people of the internet.
We'll talk about that in a minute. So... David is not here yet. I'm hoping for a potential cameo appearance.
Andres, I just have to... I know you're going to go into detail later about whatever the fuck Golden Week is, but I just have to hazard a guess. Is it a week-long celebration of the cinematic classic Eddie Murphy's The Golden Child?
Actually, it's a week-long celebration of the tokusatsu classic Golden Bat, the first ever Japanese superhero in fiction.
I was closer than I thought I would be. All right.
All right, well, where to blow your load so early? But anyway, so...
As per usual.
Yeah, that's the level of humor we're presenting tonight. So I actually wanted to open on a thing that happened to me. And a thing I've been thinking about of late that I guess kind of relates to... Not really doesn't relate to anything that we were just talking about, but I want to talk about it anyway. So we're going a little bit old school this week. We're going to open with kind of a discussion topic, and then we're going to move into the news after Andres talks about Golden Week. So what happened to me about a week and a half ago was I went to Bagel Boss. You guys have been to Bagel Boss with me. It was that very same Bagel Boss where Dylan saw his very first Jewish person.
Yes!
Jewish person, my first blatantly obvious Jewish person with the yarmulkes and the shit.
Welcome to New York.
We have plenty of plainclothes Jewish people walking around.
We had that
here.
Conversation about David Franco.
Wow, that is a fucking that was 2 years ago, motherfucker.
It was funny.
The Jewish people.
I left.
The Jewish people that I had encountered in the past before that didn't wear all that shit, and so you were forced to look at the nose to try and determine what they were doing.
They dressed like normal people.
You could also, like, wave
like
a dollar.
Like actual Americans.
You could also, like, wave a dollar around and see how they reacted. But that was it.
Oh, my God. Of course.
Why hasn't Tumblr already attacked us?
Is there a Tumblr feed that's just, like, the Sons of Serizawa podcast? Does anybody even care that they're racist?
I mean, no. We're not well enough to be judged
by the moral standings of Tumblr. Dylan just turned into a southern fucking like rancher.
He basically became Yosemite Sam.
We're not well known enough. What I was trying to say, Jesus Christ, I haven't even drank tonight.
I mean, dear God, not even G-Fest likes us.
No.
Why would they? Not at all. I mean, do you blame them?
No.
We, like, walk around their con and, like, yell in their stairwells. Why would they like us, you know? I mean,
do you remember that time we jogged up the stairs?
Yes.
And then bumped to Bob Eggleton, and I was like, hey, Bob, I'm sorry I sweated on this shirt that I bought from you. It was a thing I said to another human being.
I remember this was the beginning of the side my ass joke.
Yes.
Yeah.
And at the beginning of the, there's two things you don't know about this thing here. This one obvious thing and this other obvious thing.
That was after we saw Don Fry's panel. Yeah, and we had to go to ATM at the other hotel. Anyway.
And we climbed up the staircase and we just came out of the staircase just bursting in laughter while scaring the maid.
I still want a movie where Don Fry plays Wilford Brimley. I want it bad.
There's two things you don't know about type 2 adult onset diabetes.
All right, well, now that you guys have blown my chance for a sweet segue.
One is that you're surrounded by people.
God damn it.
The second is, I was scared, but I wasn't afraid to die.
Oh, God. I don't even remember how that fucking started. I just remember that...
to laugh at people?
No, you know what it was? It was the fact that we started talking about Don Fry looking at blatant things and telling you two things about them.
There's two things about ATM machines.
Because we had to go to the hotel. We had to go to the other hotel to go to the ATM.
Yes.
And I think what happened was I was like, I'll tell you, there's two things you don't know about ATMs. One...
They give you money.
They're automatic transition monetary... machines, and two, Godzilla.
There's two things you don't know about revolving doors. One is that they're doors, and the other is they revolve.
No, I liked it better when it was like the first thing was obvious, and then we would just say Godzilla. So it'd just be like, there's two things you don't know about this hotel. One, people stay in it, and two, Godzilla.
The odd thing is, both of those things are accurate in that case.
That's true. So, speaking of G-Fest, though, in terms of they're not, you know, really appreciating our sense of humor, which is fine and totally understandable, just to not kick up that old, you know, all that old shit. It's totally fine. I get it. Generation gaps are the thing I wanted to open on because I have a story that goes along with it. So, you guys know what I mean by the generation gap by, like, you know, just sort of the lack of kind of understanding between your older generation of people nowadays and your sort of younger generation. It's sort of an issue nowadays.
Really?
In terms of,
yeah, you know, the older folks, they don't understand the Yugimans and the Pokios.
That's exactly what I'm talking about, Dylan, is that an older man goes to a 7-Eleven and doesn't know which pack of Pokemon is limited edition. I don't even know what pack of Pokemon is limited edition. So I am the problem in this instance.
Okay.
But you guys know what I mean, right? Like, it's just like you get like this sort of just complete just lack of understanding of the world that exists now and the world that existed back then from each generation, if that makes any sense.
I kind of understand. I guess maybe in terms of like looking at things more critically as opposed to nostalgia.
You mean cynicism?
Cynicism, yes. I feel like, yeah, definitely... I think some people have often complained that this generation has become a lot more, has a lot more of that cynicism than earlier generations, where everything is held under scrutiny.
Interesting. Not exactly what I'm referring to, but sort of similar. What I'm more talking about is sort of more broad than that. I'm more just sort of talking about just even differences in music, differences in how people communicate, differences
like
in how people behave in public.
I feel like at a certain age, you stop intaking new things. Not even, like, consciously. It's just, like, your brain.
Mm-hmm. It just happens. No,
at
totally
a certain time, you're like, I want to learn new things. And your brain's like, no, fuck you, I'm tired.
Yeah, no, that's
wake me up when we
that's
die.
That's so fucking true, yeah. at a certain point, you're just like, I don't have the capacity to sit down and learn how to do a new thing because I don't care enough to put the effort into it. And I don't think I'm at that place yet because I'm still going to school, so I would hope not. But
there comes a point in your life when you just want to be put out to pasture, you know? You're just like...
and it's interesting you use pasture as the...
It happened to Harrison Ford back in 83, but he had to wait all this time for them to kill him. It was very sad.
Have you guys seen that new Netflix original series, The Ranch?
No.
Yeah. I've seen the promos for it or whatever.
It is fucking awesome. So it's Ashton Kutcher and Danny Masterson. They play brothers in it, so they're reunited from That 70s Show. And their dad is played by Sam Elliott. And they're on a ranch herding cattle. And that's the premise of the show. And it's just a family drama. It's a sitcom with cursing.
Sounds fascinating.
So
Bill,
it's kind of like...
Tell me more.
So it's like The Office, but on a farm?
No, it's so much better than that. It's fucking great. Dylan, trust me, you'll love it. Give it a shot. It's fucking great. And a lot of it is about the sort of generation gap that exists between Sam Elliott's character and his sons, because he kind of waited late in life to have kids and everything, and he's just this fucking like hard, old fucking old-school cowboy type. And they're like, you know, sort of your modern 20-somethings. And it's sort of about how they just can't relate to each other and struggling to do so. Anyway, so how does that relate back to the Bagel Boss story, you might ask? And the answer may surprise you in that it doesn't at all. No, it's just sort of this idea of the generation gap has been in my head, and it does relate back to this story. So at Bagel Boss now, I'm waiting online, or I was about to wait online, I should say, because there was like people... You ever go to a place and people just aren't standing in a cohesive single-file line? Like, they're just sort of all over the place.
Yeah.
And you can't tell who's where.
Yeah.
So you don't know where you're supposed to fucking stand as the new person entering this fucking madness. So you just sort of linger in the back and wait for people to kind of fill in the gaps to see where you kind of line up.
Or, you know, you can just ask people, are you in line?
Well, I'm...
You can do that if you want to communicate with other human beings.
That's what I'm talking about, Andres. That's the generation gap I'm referring to. That is, that's exactly what I'm talking about, because it's like, I don't care enough to ask somebody. Like, I'm like, it'll work itself out. Like, I don't care. Like, I'll wait. It's fine. The employees will fix this mess. I don't care enough to fucking intervene. I'll let it work itself out. That's the mindset that I have when I go to Bagel Boss at 2:30 in the afternoon to get a fucking egg sandwich, and I just want to go home and drink and go to bed.
At 2:30 in the morning?
2:30 in the afternoon.
I mean, the afternoon?
No, I'm not drinking at 2:30 in the afternoon. But I do want
to
go home.
You're going to bed, on the other hand.
Well, I'm getting out of fucking class. I'm not allowed to take a nap. Fuck you.
Gotta have my mid-afternoon nap, so I'll be good and alert later for my story.
Well, I'm talking about the generation gap here, and as an old man, I think it's my right to take a mid-afternoon nap.
Because you want to sleep early, that way you don't miss anything later on when you watch the evening news. When you intentionally sit down to watch the evening news, that's when it's all over, man.
That's how you know that you're not learning anything new. So here's what happened. So the last guy online turns to me and, because I think I did eventually ask, are you the last person online? I turned to this older guy who was in a suit, and he was just like, I don't know if you were before me or not, but what are you listening to? I had my earbuds in. He's like, what are you listening to? I'm just like, I do not want to explain this to this guy right now.
I guess you were listening to a podcast and you were afraid he was going to pull John Lovitz and say, what's a podcast?
No, I was listening to the soundtrack from the first Terminator, and I didn't want to explain that to him for some reason.
Say, I'm listening to the music from Terminator.
I said...
I fucking hate that question.
Right?
When somebody says,
I'm not crazy here.
When somebody is like, hey, what are you doing? Like, in any capacity, it's like, what are you listening to? What are you reading? What are you watching on the TV?
I don't want to stop doing it and explain it to you because you're not going to care anyway. That's my thought process. I'm not going to care enough to explain it to you because I know you don't give a shit. So fuck you. No. So, okay. So this guy goes, what are you listening to? If I approve of it, I'll let you cut me in line. And I'm just like, dude, I really don't care.
What
just
the
go.
Fuck?
What is he, like, some sort of strange fairy tale troll? Like...
That's what I thought at the time!
Pass across this like, bridge, tell me, what dost thou listen to in thine headphones?
What is your favorite
you
color?
You may only cross my bridge if I approve of your choice of tunes. So, I'm like, I'm listening to the soundtrack. Eventually, because he keeps asking me. This is the annoying part. He goes, well, no, tell me what you're listening to. I want to see if I approve. And I'm just like, dude.
What the fuck?
This guy was a fucking lunatic, by the way. That's the punchline to the story. This guy was fucking crazy. So he goes, well, what are you listening to? I'm just like, I'm listening to the soundtrack from a movie. And he goes, well, what movie? And I'm like, oh, dude, please don't do this to me. And I'm like, The Terminator. And he goes, oh, I've seen that one. And I'm like, everybody's seen the fucking Terminator. That's not a shock to me. I just don't want to have to now have a conversation with you about the Terminator. Because here's the introduction to this idea of the generation gap. When I go to a fucking bagel boss and I have my earbuds in, mm-hmm. maybe I'm a fucking cynical, fucking self-absorbed prick, but I don't want to talk about what fucking music I'm listening to in my earbuds to rent online. I just got out of fucking class. I'm on my way fucking home. I just want to get my food and go.
Mm-hmm.
Like, is that really a horrible fucking thing?
Not really.
A horrible mindset to have.
I know exactly how you feel, man, where it's like I would walk around with my headphones in my ears, like whether I'm walking, like bicycling to work or walking in around the mall or eating my McDonald's or whatever. I like to listen to my own, to my music or a YouTube video or podcast, and just
it's
I like to be
about...
a little lost in my I'm lost in my own little world here. I don't want to be disrupted.
You are escaping in that moment. You are relinquishing any social responsibilities that you might have at any given moment.
Dude,
when you put it in your earphones.
That reminds
and
me.
I fucking love it.
Yes, I do. I do too. And I thing I hate is that a lot of older generations. They would go on Facebook and share these these pictures saying, I'm glad in my generation we did this and not this. And you're like,
I'm just like, you're such an idiot because there's somebody like 10 years older than you sharing the very same thing but reversed with something that they grew up with. It's just like
everyone thinks that their childhood is so much better than what the kids are doing nowadays.
Yeah,
they're just
that
stuck
is,
with their
that...
phones and don't pay attention and don't socialize. And burp, 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 burp. What do you think they're doing on those phones? They're socializing.
Yeah, exactly.
What do you think
they don't think
I'm
they don't
doing
think
with
for
my
more than 2 seconds?
What do you think
about
I'm doing
yet?
With my phone right now?
It's like they think that they're just like staring at nothing, like just there's just like a fucking static screen, just psh, well, and then just look at it.
Do you think everyone is like thinking of like cell phones as like or technology as a scary thing, like everyone's plugged into the Matrix?
Yeah, exactly. That's just it.
Whenever
and it's funny.
Complain about like the current state of media. I'm like, okay, sure, you got a point. But when you complain about like current social norms, I'm like, go fuck yourself.
it's just like. People are going to behave how people feel they naturally have to behave, depending upon the situation. That's the reality. So, however that is irrelevant to sort of bitch about. You're right. But the thing is, this guy actually was kind of like, he wasn't like a dick. And I hope I'm not giving off that impression if he's listening. But I don't even know.
Did you give him his like your business card? Hey, Bill Worster, Zazubaar, YouTuber, aspiring filmmaker.
Yeah, I could have.
Does it matter what Bill's listening to in his headphone in the long run? We're all just waiting to die anyway.
That's what I'm thinking. You know that's my mindset.
You're born,
like,
you do like a 70-year bid, you know.
I'm waiting to drop dead. So this let me wait to drop dead.
average is like 70 something years usually, I guess. And then you fucking die, and then you know it's
the rate I'm going, maybe 40.
Yeah.
You should have seen the fucking crap I put in my body today. I'm talking about food. So this goes on for several minutes, and by several minutes I mean. The entirety of the time that I spent at this bagel boss was spent talking with this fucking man. So now we're online. We've established that we're online now.
Wait,
what?
Wait a minute. Did he approve of your music choices?
I don't even remember that part of it, because all I remember is what happened afterwards.
Well, if he didn't,
I don't even remember.
If he didn't let you go ahead of him in line, then obviously not, because that was the original term.
But I don't even remember. I think what ended up happening was he fucking got so caught up in the conversation that by the time that, like, we even got to the point of, like, getting back onto line, the people were ready to take our fucking orders. So it was just like, what do you guys want? Just tell me. Because, like, the bagel boss line isn't even that crazy. It's just like, you just fucking go on the line, and it's like, there's, like, six people working behind the counter. It takes 2 seconds for them to get to you. That's why I didn't even care that, like, there was even a line problem. I was just like, whatever. I just want to fucking get my food.
See what you did? You fell into a trap, Bill. Some people are so desperate for a conversation that they cannot resist. And as soon as you asked him a question, you opened up the door.
Exactly it.
My fucking mother can't, like, buy a gallon of milk at Walmart without, like, telling the cashier her life story. So, I mean, I have experience with these sorts of people.
That is exactly what I think happened here, motherfuckers, because the conversation that happened afterwards is 10 times weirder than the initial fucking question. So I explained to him that I'm listening to the Terminator soundtrack. I don't really remember what his thought was. But now, at this point, we've involved the fucking fact that the people behind the counter are trying to take our order, and this guy has become obsessed with me and my taste in music. Because he's then like, have you ever heard this song? Oh, have you ever heard this song? Oh, have you ever heard this song? I'm like,
no.
He was trying to, like, gauge my taste in music because I was so fucking, like, reluctant to tell him what I was listening to.
You ever hear I Can Feel It Coming in the Air at Night?
And you may think, like, why were you so reluctant to tell him what you were listening to? But it's just, it wasn't even, like, because I didn't want to, it wasn't even because I was just, like, I don't want to tell him for any reason. It's just because I'm like, why do I have to tell you? Like why? Like, just, what in the moment is going to make this happen for me?
Entitled to that.
Like, what do I get out of this? So that was more of it. And so then, again, now the fucking people are trying to take our orders for our food. And he's fucking like, oh, have you ever heard this song? Have you ever heard this song? And I'm like, oh, I'm trying. I'll get an egg sandwich, 2 scrambled eggs on a fucking bagel. By the way, that's what I like if you ever want to order me food.
throwing that out there to the universe.
Yeah, I'm just putting that out there to the internet. I like scrambled eggs on a plain bagel, toasted with butter, please. I really like that. So
por favor.
Now, guys, it gets even worse now. So now I'm trying to order my food, and this guy's trying to order his food too. And I can tell, because I'm in the customer service industry, I know what happens. When you look at something, I can just see in the person behind the counter's eye, when you're trying to take a customer's order, when they're talking to somebody, it is the most annoying fucking thing in the world. Because it's just like, you don't want to be rude and break up the conversation, but you also want to do your fucking job. So I felt really, really guilty in that moment. So then guess what this fucker decides to do? He's like, oh my god, you have to listen to this song. And again, I forget what the song was. And I'm just like, oh yeah, I'll have to look that up later. And he goes, no, you have to listen to it right now. And I'm just like, dude, you're fucking with me right now. You're not literally going to make me play a song.
I would have stabbed this person. Oh my god.
So he goes, all right, I'm going to try and get it up on my phone. And I'm like, oh,
he's gonna
no.
He's
going
to try to get it up. Oh, God.
So he pulls out his gigantic fucking smartphone, right? And listen, so let me describe this guy a little bit. Like, the only things I had to go on of this dude in this moment of my life. He looked vaguely sort of 50. Like, he looked vaguely like the same age as my dad, or like, or anybody our age, like their parents, like sort of that age.
So he had grayish hair?
Yeah, blackish to grayish hair. And he's in a business suit, so I kind of figured,
that or
not
all right.
That. Yeah, mid-range. You know, he looked a lot like Jeff Goldblum, not gonna lie. Uh-huh. So imagine Jeff Goldblum, and not
like,
modern
like,
Jeff Goldblum.
Okay, I was gonna say Independence Day Resurgence Jeff Goldblum.
No, like Law and Order Criminal Intent Jeff Goldblum.
Have you ever heard the soundtrack to Jurassic Park?
I'm just like, dude, every fucking day. So
that's chaos there.
That is chaos theory. So
and imagine the moment you abandon him, he's like, now I'm here ordering and talking to myself. Now that's chaos theory.
Oh, Andres, I really wish I had the balls to abandon. I mean, I could know. What could I have done to break up this? You'll see, there's nothing I could have done without being an asshole.
Tiny so, variations.
in my fucking heart, will make it whether or not I fucking strangle you right now.
I know, so, Bill. I can feel your anger.
So, fucking, this guy, he pulls out his phone, and he's like, I don't have any reception. Can you look it up on your phone?
Oh my god.
Can you please use your data for me?
And I'm just like, motherfucker, what?
So that you can listen to this song that you don't really give a fuck about. Wonderful.
No, so I didn't say that. I was like, I said to him, I was like, you want me to look it up on what? And he goes, do you have YouTube on your phone? I'm like, yeah. And he goes, well, can you pull it up on there? I'm like, how long is it? And he goes, it's like 3 minutes. I'm like, I'm not listening.
You should have lied and said I ran out of data for the month.
I should have, but I was an idiot.
He doesn't know what data is. The guy's 50, you know?
The thing. Like, I couldn't really figure out, like, that was the weird part.
Whenever
so the first
asked
song...
me to look something up on YouTube, I'm like, no, because then I'm going to have all these, like, suggestions in my feed.
So the song he had me, so I ended up looking it up because I'm a fucking idiot, and the song I ended up looking up was like from the late 60s, and I'm like, all right, this makes sense. It sounds like something that like my uncle would listen to, like my old uncle, and he's just like, oh, what do you think of that? I'm like, it's fine, because remember, all this insanity is in the quest to find out what my taste in music is, mm-hmm. And I'm just like, it's fine. So then. He is like, all right, I have another song. And I'm like, dude, are you fucking for real?
Oh my god.
So he's pulling up more songs. And now the guy from behind the counter has come back to be like, I have a question for you, for me. And I'm just, this guy is trying to describe this song to me. Because guess what? He couldn't fucking remember the name of the band.
Don't
now.
Tell me he's singing it. Like, he's singing the tune.
No, none of that. None of that. Thank God. I don't think it ever got that bad. But... It was hilarious because he was trying to like figure out what music I like grew up on, because he was like getting closer and closer to the modern age every time he pulled up a song. So just to save time, we went through like 5 songs. I'm not kidding.
While you were waiting, while you were waiting for your food to be processed,
why does it take so fucking long for a bagel?
Well, you remember, there's a lot of people there, and they have to they cook everything, so it took like 5 minutes. But we didn't listen to the whole songs. Like, we just listened to little pieces of them. But just the process of looking them up and playing them and watching ads on the videos.
Oh, were they the kind you could skip after a few seconds or the annoying kind?
Both.
Oh.
And this guy progressively just keeps pulling up weirder and weirder music. At one point, he pulled up fucking Korn. The porn, and I'm like, who are you? Like, where did you fucking come from? Like, why do you know what corn is?
Maybe he's one of those.
I barely know what corn is.
Maybe he's one of those, like, individuals who's just, like, he's so desperate to get in touch with the kids nowadays that he's willing to expand his taste in music.
Is this what's hip now? Well, yeah, like, 30 years ago. Go away.
What a. What about just these new kids, Backstreet Boys?
No, what about those other new kids? I don't remember their name, but they're on the block, and,
So here's the big explanation moment, to me anyway. I don't know if this
How's
is
that
true.
Aaron Carter fellow doing nowadays?
Oh!
You hear that about this guy, Ripps? He's actually
I bet you I'm like one of the few people on the internet who has brought up the name of Aaron Carter.
Oh man, like
AKA Justin Bieber version 1.0.
Eric Carter?
Aaron.
You sure?
I think it's A-R-O-N.
And Love Candy, that guy?
Yes, that guy!
Okay, I just wanted to make sure. So, I'm shocked we didn't listen to that, genuinely.
Elvis on the television last night.
So here's the big explanation moment. He goes, oh, how old are you? And I'm just like, dude, like, what is, are you trying to fuck me? Like, what is this?
And couldn't he have opened with that? Like, I think that would have made this a lot easier.
Yeah, yeah, right?
What's the That's name, what I fucking stranger?
I probably should have told them I was born in the 90s, but I didn't, because I didn't give a shit.
He's trying so hard to get into this conversation. Meanwhile, you're trying so hard to get out of it.
I barely even entered it. Like, I responded. I gave such little of my attention. I don't even think I took out my headphones, to be honest. I think I took out one. And just paused the other. So, where was I? Explanation moment. Guy goes... I was like, oh, I was born in 94. I'm 21. He goes, oh, you were born around the same time as my kids. Oh, so you probably have similar taste in music and as them. And he starts going on about how he doesn't really get to hang out with his kids anymore. Oh, because God. They're always off at school and shit.
Well, boo fucking who. Welcome to parenting.
Like, at this point, I would just be like, do you want money? Like, what's going on here?
That was my I was like, oh, so that's what just happened. I just had a pity conversation with an old man who doesn't get to talk to his kids anymore. And I was just like...
Get it, you're the old guy from Home Alone. Everybody in the neighborhood thinks you murdered a guy and, like, no...
I feel please. Really bad, but, dude, what the fuck? So, I literally... here was my saving grace. Here's what saved my life in this moment.
Spider-Man, so, because everybody gets one.
Spider-Man just jumps in into the bagel into the bagel restaurant. Hey everyone.
He fucking punches the dude in the face.
You're like, thanks.
Knocks him out cold. Bill's knocks
like, thanks,
out all
Spider-Man.
His
fucking... Everybody gets one.
I'm just like, oh man, Spidey, thanks. But then he punches me in the face and knocks out all my teeth. Because I had the audacity to open my mouth to him anyway.
You dare speak to the Spider-Man?
So, we get our food, and of course we get it at the same time, so I couldn't have used that as an excuse. I'm walking to the door, and he's fucking following me, of course, and he's like, oh, are you staying here to eat? I'm like, fuck no. Imagine. I was like, no, I'm going home. And he just goes, oh, okay.
Where do you live?
Well, can I play you one more before you go?
Fuck you.
And I'm just like, oh, man, I really, really got to go. And he's like, just quickly. I'm just like, oh, what? and at that point, I was like, I'm making it clear that I'm not happy. So that was my genuine response. All right, yeah. So I listened to this one last song. And I'm just like, dude, like, what the fuck? I don't even remember what the last fucking song was. I don't even remember.
I hope so.
How about them Spice Girls? Have they finally become Spice Women already?
The word symphony was in the title, I think. I don't remember, but it was like a new song. It wasn't like a fucking 18th century symphony. anyway, so...
How about this Beethoven fella? He this up-and-comer.
That was basically it.
I'm still waiting for his next collaboration.
Oh man, and then at one point the guy he was like, "Oh, we should totally hang out sometime," like jokingly. It's like, "Oh yeah, I don't live around here," and then I left.
Which is funny because you live pretty damn close to there.
Yeah, I'm like two blocks away. No, a little more than that, but it's pretty.
And if he asked you your name, you go by the name of Rusty Shackleford.
I think I said my name was Bill. I don't remember if I did or not.
Or you can go by your pseudonym of Will.
Whoa.
Yeah.
What would you do?
That's what I call people I want to have sex with because they won't be able to look me up on the internet afterwards.
What would you do if this fucking guy wound up like moving in like across the street and like?
I would kill myself. So yeah, that was my generation gap story. Just because I felt in that moment I felt like it was a dad who felt like he didn't understand his kids anymore, who tried to understand another kid, and it completely blew up in his face because now I hate that guy. And if I ever see him again, I'm gonna hit him with my fucking car. No. Well, maybe. I don't know. We'll see what happens.
What if he's in the bagel boss every time you go, Bill? What if he's waiting there for you?
Yeah, I'm gonna kill myself. Because I really like that bagel boss, you guys know. So I need that in my life. They're actually closed right now for Passover. Or Golden Week, I wouldn't know.
Hanukkah, guess, who knows what these people, yeah.
Who fucking knows what they
Chris
celebrate?
Hanukkah.
It's not American, so who cares?
You gotta go light their lamps and spin their dreidels or whatever.
But you guys never just have something like that where just somebody in public is just like, I want to have a conversation with you right now. And every physical and, like, just delivery-wise, like, implication they give off is just, I do not want to talk to you right now. And they don't care.
I want spinning an...
Like, at that point, who's the bigger asshole?
I want spending an entire semester in a class sitting next to a person who thought I liked them.
Oh, man. And that's always the worst.
Constant conversations. And just their inane voice about... all the bullshit that they had to do for their classes, like papers and shit. And then, because I was so thrilled by those conversations, then it would like talk about like fucking D&D, and I'm like, I don't care, man. Like,
oh no,
I'm not that kind of nerd. God.
So yeah, listen, man. I don't even read books. I'm not about that life. So here's what I want to ask you. So when you're sitting in the class, when it's the class conversation, when you're in class and you're talking to another person who you don't want to talk to because they fucking started the conversation, and inevitably the conversation is about school, how do you find yourself like pretending like you give more of a shit about school when you're talking to this person?
Oh,
just
yeah.
To like,
totally.
Just to match up with whatever fucking they're dishing out in terms of the conversation. Like they'll be like, oh,
I turn into that guy from BoJack Horseman, the three kids on top of each other in the trench coat, who's just all like, yes, yes, business, business, business. I've been businessing with business. So
yes, business, I feel that so much. Such the mindset of an underachiever, I feel, where I'm just like, yeah, I studied for so many hours last night for that test. Yeah, definitely. Oh, I'm so stressed out about that class. Yeah, I don't know what I'm going to do for it. Yeah.
Yeah, I totally...
It's really nice, though. I don't know.
Yeah, I totally wrote the paper.
Yeah. I showed up that day, definitely. Yeah. Are you going to the big social event? No, there's a social event at this school?
Please, tell me about it. It's because I'm super invested in this conversation.
Where can I sign up? Oh, yeah, great.
Think about it. Sounds interesting.
One guy was like, I'm directing a play. Will you come watch it? And I was like, no, probably not.
Oh. So let me ask you guys, who's the bigger asshole in that moment? That person or you?
Oh, me, definitely.
Yeah, me, right. It's just, I don't know, well, the problem is, you're pretending to give a shit. It's your fucking fault. If you just didn't pretend to give a shit...
That's the worst part, Bill. I don't even pretend, but some of these people are so fucking dense.
It's
gotta be on the one hand, it's like the conversation starter. He has to be aware that whether or not the person he's talking to is even interested in the conversation. So if the person is clearly showing disdain, then it's their response. It's their fault for not ending it.
Right.
But more than that,
don't you guys, whenever you talk to anybody, just 10 seconds into the conversation go, why am I talking to this person? Oh, yeah, okay, that's why.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, right now, I'm like, I'm talking to you guys because we're doing a podcast.
Yeah.
Like, there's a reason why we're talking right now. Also, we happen to be friends, but that's just collateral.
Friendship.
And I may like you guys. I'm not sure. I'm still figuring it out.
What, like 3 years into this?
Two road trips where we spent 24 hours, several groups of 24 hours together, like just straight. I'm still not sure.
So about this road trip.
Yeah, I don't know. We haven't worked out the details for the new one, the next one yet, so don't even joke about that right
really
now.
Really?
I do. I will say that I did get the approval from my boss to have the G-Fest week off.
All right, cool. So at least we have that much. We have that much planned out.
I have to go to a convention about like your culture that you don't give a shit about, but I do. And like,
right. I'm going to fly to America.
By the way, whenever I talk about...
See Godzilla stuff.
Well, it's definitely a lot more Godzilla stuff than I'll ever find here.
You can see Godzilla stuff here. We are in a Japan... Yeah, but nobody's enthusiastic about it.
Yeah, but nobody cares.
By the way, I mostly find Kamen Rider and Super Sentai stuff. Barely any Godzilla.
over there, like, there are at least, like, five people who care, and, like,
they congregate the
building, and, like, you know, it's air-conditioned, it's nice.
Well, Andres, I guess you might as well just jump right into an American, Mexican, and Japan. That's the theme song I came up with.
We should find, like, a cover, we should find a cover of that piece of mariachi music, but played on, like, a Japanese, like, instrument.
Yeah, like, on, like, a flute, yeah, like, just, like, a...
Or what do you call it, like, what do you call that Japanese guitar, like, a, not a sitar.
Well, what you want, okay, so I keep doing the din-na-na-na-na, because I'm racist, and I think of the Chinese, like, din-na-na-na-na-na-na-na. But that's just because, I'm going to tell you why that is, by the way, because people are going to think I'm more racist than I actually am.
Uh-huh.
It's because the characters are the same, and whenever I hear that bell, I see Japanese, like, text. I mean, like, Chinese, like, just Asian characters, like, mm-hmm. Asian text, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I see that, so that's why I think of every Asian culture ever, because that I see Asian characters.
Funny enough,
in my
like,
head.
I think the Chinese and Japanese might share some the same kanji.
But they do,
yeah, but for the most part, the katakana and hiragana of the Japanese alphabet are their own thing. The kanji,
I think they do anyway. I don't actually know. I heard that, I think, at one point.
Because there are three different types of lettering when it comes to Japanese writing. There's the hiragana, which is like the basic kind. Every single symbol represents every single symbol represents a syllable. A, I, u, e, o, ka, ki, ku, ke, ko, ma, mi, mu, me, mo, so on and so forth. Then there's the katakana, which are the alphabets that you use to spell foreign words. So, like...
Oh, beautiful.
A word like... Rather than trying to come up with their own... rather than trying to use hiragana to spell out hamburger, or trying to invent a new Japanese word for hamburger, they would use katakana to spell ham-ba-ga. So basically, so if you ever
like that scene in the Pink Panther remake.
So if you ever hear like, if you know katakana and you read katakana, you are essentially speaking English with a stereotypical accent over it.
That's great.
Umbaga.
I love it.
So that's like when you're watching a fucking Godzilla movie and you just hear English words, right?
Yeah. But they would.
Babura.
Babura. Or like my name, I recently got a Honko stamp. Not recently, this was like like last month when I was settling
Andres,
in.
is that like a tramp stamp? Like you get that on your ass, like a tattoo?
They don't use signatures for legal documentation here. They use signature stamps or honkos.
I actually like that idea because it's less work.
That's fucking great.
But
why
on the other hand,
use that?
I think it's because it's easy to reproduce, like, to copy a honko
stamp. Oh, okay, that makes sense.
Like, here in Japan, they don't have to worry about that. But in America, if you
I mean,
can,
I would still
if you
worry
can
about
fuck
it,
the system, you can, you know, in America, there are more people willing to, like, to screw the system than in Japan, where everyone
That's
has.
The problem with an opportunistic culture, my friend.
People
are opportunistic.
I mentioned this before.
The system's doing a great job of screwing us already, so why not, you know?
That's the thing. That's the fucking mindset.
What's wrong with this country?
A lot of Japanese businesses, you know, a lot of Japanese lifestyle is reliant on a system of trust. I mean, I can actually leave my bag outside, leave my front door unlocked, and I can guarantee that that bag will not be stolen and no one will break into this house because it's that level of trust here.
Things like were like
really?
That in America
is that
once.
Because I fucking wouldn't do that, even if I lived there for a year.
I still don't do that.
Still, things were like that in America once. There was a time you could leave your door unlocked and go off to work, and you know, it would be fine. The milkman would come in and fuck your wife and everything would be...
Yeah, things were fine. Again, opportunistic. The opportunity was there for the milkman to... put some milk in my wife, and he did it.
But he didn't rob you, is the thing. He would fuck your wife, but he didn't rob you, and you know...
He robbed me of pussy.
You're gonna get that later anyway. She doesn't even have a choice. It's the 50s.
I don't want sloppy stuff.
She didn't have a choice!
It's the 50s. She doesn't have a choice. You can spank her if she says no, yeah.
That's true. I forgot about that.
That's also
part... You want to go back in time? It sounds so good back then.
The 50s are great if you're a white man, and I'm a white man.
That's true. We should hop in a DeLorean. No, we should hop in a... We should hop in an Indiana Jones fridge and get nuked back in time.
Wait, hold on. To make a callback to a super early episode of the SOS, you mean to tell me you build a time machine out of a Ghidorah?
Yeah.
No, and the other great thing you could do is, like, set up a bank account and then let it accrue interest and then come back to the present, and you'd be fucking rich.
That is the only reason time travel should ever exist, is for the that to be a thing. And by that should be the, and by saying that that's the reason it should exist, that's exactly the reason it shouldn't exist. Yeah, let's hop into Golden Week, Andres.
Wait. We were talking about Honko Stamp. Why was I talking about? Oh yeah, Honko Stamp, because on my signature stamp, it's Perez in katakana, three symbols that spell out Perezu. So that's what I use.
They drag out Perez into that many characters.
Name is Perezu?
Perezu.
Wait, how?
That is hilarious. I'm gonna call you that.
Everything ends in a everything. Every Japanese word ends in a syllable. Ends in a vowel. Every Japanese word ends in a vowel except for the letter N. And there's actually a, even though there are hiraganas for na, ni, nu, ne, no, there is a separate katakana for just N, for N, the sound of N.
So because your name ends with a Z, there has to be a U at the end of it?
Yes.
What about,
I see.
What about your first name? How do they say your first name?
Andresu, I think.
So Andresu Perezu.
Your name is
Andresu Perezu.
Andresu Perezu.
That sounds so redundant.
Andresu Perezu. No. It's everything. I would have to say I'm Perezu Andresu. But
what?
Everything, you have to say the last name first before saying the first. It's the last name first.
Oh, so okay, that makes a lot more sense then. So
all legal documentation is Perez Andres instead of Andres Perez.
Have you noticed any difficulty with your students, Andres, and the letter L?
Yes, and I make that a big deal about them. I say, you know, I always show them you have to move the tongue around because I guess they don't move their, when they speak Japanese, they don't move their mouth a lot as much as how people move their mouths when they're talking in English. And so
their tongues are they live a very sedentary lifestyle.
Like I would be sure to tell them, like, look, guys, the rest of the world knows that you say R's when you mean L's, and like
you are pulling the wool over anybody's eyes.
I can see them. Like,
you are
my
being
adult
made
students
fun of constantly.
I can smell your fear.
For my adult students, it's
because
like,
you say things like, "Ooh,
them.
I have to pay the beers," and it's like,
for my adult students that honestly try to pronounce the words correctly, I can see them struggling. And when I say, yes, that's it, you got it, they're like, holy shit, I have to do that every time? I'm like, Jesus.
Oh, man.
Is it really that hard, though? Is English really that hard? I don't know. I mean, I was raised in it.
You were raised in it? You were inside of the English?
They really
also,
the English.
Also,
I was born in it.
For the Japanese language, everything is pronounced very quickly. It's like, while us, we tend to spend a little more time with each syllable. So, what's it like? What's a Japanese word? Onegaishimasu is like, can I have this? So it's like when you're ordering food, kore onegaishimasu. Well, they would say kore onegaishimasu very fast. While in English, you would say onegaishimasu. You would make sure to pronounce everything clearly rather than rushing through it.
In English, you would say, give me a fucking burger.
They would say, give me a fucking burger.
Although, we take our time.
Have you had to discuss the differences between American English and English English? Because
the
quite
biggest
different.
Thing I would normally point them out to them is the letter Z. Because we say Z, other countries say Z.
Yes.
And
God,
so,
I hate that so much.
And because they live next to us, very close to Australia, they tend to say Z more than Z. But I would quickly tell them, in America, we say Z.
All right, let's talk about it for a second.
Dragon Bar Z. Okay.
Yeah, okay, let's talk about it for a second.
Or, you would hear, like, if you listen to characters in the anime, Mazinger Z, all the anime characters would say, Mazinger Z.
Yeah, they did that in the trailers for Resurrection F 2. It was like, but it sounded like they were saying like Zeto. I was like, what the fuck?
Zeto. I don't know, maybe.
Like, so why? Like, it doesn't make any sense. It's a Z.
That's the
just
thing.
Say Z.
I honestly, the thing is, they like to bastardize the English language whenever they try to incorporate it into the Japanese language, especially in the form. That's what katakana is, essentially bastardized foreign words.
All right, that makes sense.
And they
sense,
don't have
you know?
Any SJWs getting up their ass about it.
But we do that all the time, too, because half of our language is fucking Latin, a whole bunch of other shit.
At least you know how to say tortilla instead of tortilla.
So,
wait, what?
No, here's what I'm saying.
Mind, Andres.
Why did Zed even start out being a thing? Like, who looked at a Z and said, Zed?
Because other countries say Zed?
Bill, it's not a matter of English people looking at Z and deciding, we're going to call that Zed. It's more of a matter of American people looking at Zed and saying, hey, let's just shorten that to Z. Like, you realize
that... But that makes so much
more sense. English was around first, right? Like,
no, I know, I get that, but how was that the first thought is what I'm asking.
It was probably
how was that the initial thought? Like, oh, that's Zed.
It was probably a carryover from the languages that we're derived from. You know, we're very similar...
I guess,
very
yeah,
similar to
sense.
German, and in German, the Z is called Zed.
All right, that makes sense. Okay, upsets me still, but it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'll get over it.
Oh, yeah.
Being outraged at things that are beyond my control.
So I just mentioned hiragana and katakana, and then kanji. Almost every sign you would see in Japan uses kanji, and kanji is essentially a shortcut for hiraganas. So instead of writing down three hiraganas, you can write down a kanji that represents those three hiraganas, and there's over 2,000 hiraganas, and if you really want to be extremely proficient at Japanese, you would need to learn the kanji. If you want to be proficient at reading Japanese, you would need to learn as much kanji as you can.
I gotcha. That makes
this
sense.
This is why I have Robert Scott Field, and by half him, I mean I see him once a year, and he translates what the nice people are saying.
Well, if you
identify him from across the room.
If you want to have a job like Robert Scott Field and be a proficient translator, you would need to in Japan. If you want to be work in Japan, and you're a foreigner, and you're required to take certain tests to show your proficiency in Japanese. There's there are five levels. There's N5, N4, N3, N2, and N1. Most foreigners, they stop at N5 or N4. A lot of the people that I know.
So you can't just drop one Japanese word and they're impressed. Like, you couldn't just walk in and be Naruto, and they'd be oh.
A lot of people seem to be impressed by the very little Japanese I've managed to learn, where it's if I would tell somebody, Nihongo wakarimasen, I do not speak Japanese, they would be impressed that I knew that much alone. Or
they would judge you because you were lying to them, but you know, because you just fucking spoke Japanese to them, you lying sack of shit.
If I told someone, excuse me, I would say sumimasen, and they'd be like, oh, he knows Japanese, so there's an immediate level of respect from the local to the foreigner, because if you don't speak Japanese, you know, they're just going to say, oh, this guy, but if you speak Japanese, they're going to be like, okay.
In America?
Yeah, it does, I think.
Is that instant thing of respect? Does that instant,
they're gonna come over here, they need to learn our language.
But Dylan, when you see somebody who looks like they've immigrated from another country, and you discover that they speak perfect English, do you instantly just go, oh, okay, is there really some fucking button switch in your head that just instantly makes you treat them
obviously
this is somebody who I should identify as somebody to be, I don't know, you see what I mean though?
I don't think you're really conscious of it, but
I think we're less conscious of it than the Japanese are.
See a person and you wouldn't peg them for someone who speaks English, and then they wind up speaking perfect English, sometimes way better English than you're speaking, and there's just a moment in your head oh, they're a proper person, I need to...
Oh yeah, that I feel, that I get. But I'm just saying, I think you're right though, I think it's we're less conscious of that, oh, well, I now treat this person with more respect because they know the language that we're supposed to be speaking in this country. I mean, and I guess I should. You know what? It's weird that I feel that way, because I feel like I should have more of that instant sense of respect, because I work in customer service, and when people come in who don't speak English, it's a nightmare.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
So I feel like I should have more of that, but I don't know. It's more of a given, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Well, this is a thing that should be true.
Have you had to explain to your students yet, Andres, that you drive on a parkway and park in a driveway.
Yeah.
That blew my mind.
I never thought about that until recently, but yeah.
I drive on a parkway. Park in a driveway.
Yeah,
there are all kinds of weird things like that.
Oh yeah. Oh, I did tell one of my foreign friends. She's from Indonesia, but she knows she's fluent in English and is really decent at Japanese. But I told her, I shared her this one thing I found on Facebook where it's like, read and lead rhyme, but red does not rhyme with lead, and read does not rhyme with lead.
Yeah.
No, but red and lead would rhyme.
Yes.
Yeah. That's the thing.
Did you ever think about that, Andres? And all your fancy school learning, did you ever think about that shit?
It's all been a lie. Throw my laptop out the window, crashes the ninja it. Man,
have you had to have the conversation yet about homophones?
I forgot homophones. What were those?
It's when...
What a great English teacher this kid is.
Andres,
I don't know technical terms.
I'm kidding.
It's when you have words that sound the same, but they're not the same. There
I teach conversational
and there,
English,
there.
Damn it.
And two and two and two.
Oh,
three,
I have actually started teaching that to one of my private students.
One of your
private students?
Students?
Yeah, private students, yeah.
Do you get tips?
No. I have a salary.
There was a moment where I genuinely thought you were going to say yes. Just because...
Nobody tips outside of America.
Oh, they don't tip in Japan?
Nobody tips outside of America
No, it's not a thing. Because tipping is a scam, Bill. You see, it's all so that the people who run the places don't have to pay their people a decent wage.
Right? I knew that, but I didn't know America was the only country that... I genuinely didn't know
everyone thinks that America is weird for tipping.
It was a practice
I think it's weird.
It was a practice that came about in the Great Depression, and it stuck around because if you ever, say something against it, all of a sudden, you're fucking the guy from the one scene in Reservoir Dogs, and everybody was like, oh, fuck you, man, these waitresses, they don't make enough money, and you're like, yeah, but that's the fucking business's fault.
Yeah. No, I feel that. I was not denying that at all, although as somebody whose livelihood greatly depends on tips, I'm going to shut my fucking face. So, Andres not having that, you fucking sellout. Because that's what you are. You're a fucking sellout.
Are you gonna be that stormtrooper who the moment you see me in New York you're gonna be like traitor?
Well, I mean, it was already gonna be a thing. Now I'm just gonna beat you with a fucking. You know those things like remember that scene in Watchmen where Adrian Veidt beats up that guy with that fucking what is that called?
It was a thing
that
roping. I'm... Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, like the roping thing, like that's what's gonna happen. I'm just gonna beat you to death.
I mean, the moment you left the
before park, shoving a oh no, that'd be a spoiler for people who haven't read Watchmen.
The moment
who hasn't read Watchmen.
The moment that you left the podcast last time, we immediately were just like,
oh fuck okay. You guys!
I don't even remember what we said.
I listened to that.
I don't even remember what we
you
said.
I was like, oh, fucking Andres, he can't stop talking about Japan. You know, I thought he talked going to his friends. I thought we were his friends. Fuck that guy. The fucking piece of shit. Having a life. Where is life?
That's so fucking funny.
It was pretty great.
I was really happy that was what happened. It was all capped off beautifully, by the way, when I accidentally said, well, that's it for this week's episode of the Demons from Outer Space.
there was a moment where you're just like, you know what, you know, Andres should just take this section of the podcast and just upload it on his own channel. I honestly almost would have done that had it not been for my laptop. It would have been like Zazubaar and Super DM64's real thoughts on Kaiju Noir.
And it would have been so true.
And then you would just have a picture of sad Draco Azul. You had that picture being zoom in while hearing "Hello, darkness, my old friend."
You find two random pictures of Dylan and I smiling on Facebook. You Photoshop them together, and you just make that. You make it look like we're laughing at you.
I don't think.
Which we were. We were making fun of you. Just bear in mind.
I don't think he could find that, Bill.
That's true, Dylan. You don't smile at all. There's you know what? There's one picture I know that I know of you where you're smiling. It's the picture of you and Ed Gojajewski. You were smiling, and that is the only picture I've ever seen of you where you were smiling.
Was I? See, I always turn up the corners of my mouth slightly, but usually it's too small to it's usually too small to register on camera, I found.
No, you see, what would happen
it's not
is
detectable by the human eye.
Occasionally one slips through.
See, the thing is, if Dylan ever smiles too much on camera, then the universe itself would shatter, like that one episode of The Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy.
I mean, why do you think I never ended up doing what I said I was going to do and put up the video of the recording of our webcams every week? Because they would destroy the internet with Dylan fucking smiling. Because it's the only time you ever see him do it, kids. That's true. Dylan smiles for us, his friends. Not for you. You don't deserve it. You can handle it. You can't.
Can't handle the
truth. So anyway.
Yeah.
So anyways, about...
By the way, I apologize just for, like, how, like, just aggressive and out there I'm being tonight. I'm really, really tired.
Yeah.
I should just turn over the reins to Andres. Andres, what do you want to talk about now?
Oh, wait. I never finished talking about those Japanese tests that foreigners would take.
And it goes back to talking about Japan again, of course, as always.
So, Andres, what did your friends have to do when they took these?
Yeah, Andres, tell us about your friends.
Your one friend who hates China but won't admit it.
Oh, no, I can't believe I shared that.
We didn't say who it was. It could be me for all they know.
She hates the Chinese.
The horrible people, I can't.
But anyways, to wrap this all back to what we were originally talking about, if you want to pass the highest Japanese exam in order to have a really good job as a translator here in Japan, you would need to know the test is mostly reliant on kanjis, on recognizing kanjis.
I gotcha.
All right. Oh,
that was a lot that we just went through. That was an emotional journey, my friends.
Yes.
All just to find out what kanjis you have to know to pass the Japanese translator exam. That was interesting, though. I like that.
Golden Week.
How are you enjoying the Japanese cuisine, Andres? Have you found anything to fill the void left in your life by the emptiness of no Taco Bell?
Fucking katsudon, which is like breaded pork mixed in egg and served with rice.
Yeah, we talked about that.
It's fucking delicious. So that's been like my big thing.
That's awesome. Is there any? So the Japanese don't really do fast food outside of McDonald's.
Katsudon, like Katsuya and Sukiya, are considered like fast food chains in terms of like this is a place where they serve food really fast, as opposed to a restaurant where you go there, you order, and you wait for a long time for the food to be prepared.
Wait, do you take it out in a bag?
Let's see. Do they have to go?
Is there a to-go culture in Japan?
There is a to-go culture. You can just, like, pay for the food at the register as opposed to eating it at the restaurant. They still have a waiter or waitress come to you, you order, and then they bring the food to you at your table. But if you want it to go, you order at the register like you would at McDonald's.
But after you eat it, do you feel like terrible about your life decisions? Because if not, it's not true fast food.
Yeah. Do you wipe your face with the bag?
No, because there is no bag.
You just look down at yourself and
that's
cry.
That's so depressing. There has to be a bag, Andres. I can't do the fast food without a bag.
It's depressing how non-depressing this Japanese fast food is.
I know. That's the thing about Japan. That's the reaction I have to Japan whenever Andres talks about it. It sounds too good to be true. That, like, I feel like if I ever was there in person, I'll just be so cynical and filled with hate that I just won't enjoy myself. I'll just be like, the fact that this exists upsets me.
I long for the griminess of my homeland.
I mentioned before, like with my friends, it's like the moment I start going, I go back to America in July, these motherfuckers are gonna make fun of me when I can't finish my Carl's Jr. my Hardee's burger.
Oh, well, nothing's changed then, Andres.
First things first, we're not fucking going to Carl's Jr. or Hardee's again because I don't like their fucking garbage food.
Then why did we go there the last 2 years?
I don't remember.
Because it's like the only restaurant for miles, and it's always the point in the trip where we're hungry.
I think that... Didn't we stop at the same fucking Hardee's?
Yes, it's the same...
From the previous year?
They have them spaced out in such a way that if you're hungry at that leg of the journey, that's the only place you can stop.
Didn't I get a fucking shake at the last time, too? Like, why? What was wrong with me? Oh, my God.
Remember the time you stood in line for a Cinnabon?
Several times. I think I did that on the trip, too. Yes. No, Andres got a Cinnabon the first time.
I was already full because I had Subway from the gas station we were at prior to stopping at at Carl's Jr.
I remember I got Carvel once and I didn't finish it. That was a thing that I did. Anyway.
The first year we went, we got fucking ice cream at your place of business.
No, I was talking about on the trip, like on the road, the road car.
I found out that there's a 31 flavors Baskin Robbins here.
In Japan?
Yeah.
Is there a Carvel?
Are they?
Can I get a job over there?
No, but you can get a job at Baskin Robbins if you pass one of those Japanese exams.
Bill,
they know. They know, Andres.
There aren't even Carvels like south of the Mason-Dixon. Why do you?
No, I know. Yeah, it's an East thing.
Oh, there's a. I sent you a text like months ago, Bill, where there's. A Carvel in San Diego now.
I saw that and I was like, I have to respond to that, and I just never did. I forgot.
So I was like, I thought that would make him. I thought that would make him happy.
No, I guess not. I genuinely saw that. I was like, holy shit! And I was just like, I was so busy in the moment that I just forgot to respond.
Although I did see some Carvel ice cream like being sold at a Walmart, but no actual locations.
Wait, in like a gallon jug?
No, it wasn't like just like regular ice cream though. It was an ice cream cake. Like it was.
Oh, okay, yeah. That we do. That we do sell like just around. But that's the one thing that Carvel doesn't do that they're fucking idiots for not. Sorry to my corporate masters or whatever. why don't they sell them in jug? Like they don't sell them in the gallon containers or whatever.
I mean, I've never had a Carvel ice cream cake, but based on past experience, I would imagine it to just be a slightly shittier version of a Dairy Queen ice cream cake.
I mean, probably. It's fine. Probably. I've never had a Dairy Queen ice cream cake.
Oh, dude, the Blizzard cakes are fucking.
I imagine it's probably pretty good, but I don't really like ice cream cake as a thing. Like I fucking make them for a living, and And I don't really like them that much because I'm just like, I'd just rather have ice cream. By the way, I have ice cream waiting for me for after this podcast.
I just remember when
I'm getting fatter having this conversation.
I know, me too, yeah.
Okay. So, Golden Week. Yeah, that's the thing.
No, I was kidding, Andres. We don't have to rush. I was joking. I'm not like, let's wrap this up now.
I think that was the thing I wanted to talk about.
You're talking about ice cream and I can just feel my thighs spreading.
Golden Week. Every year there is a national week-long holiday called Golden Week. And the funny thing about Golden Week is that everyone knows about Golden Week, but they don't know why we have Golden Week or where Golden Week came from. What's the purpose of Golden Week? Gave me a lot of material to work with when having.
You are such a. I'm sorry to stop you. Yeah. You're such a teacher now, by the way. What is the purpose of Golden Week? It's just like I feel like I'm in class, but like a good class.
Yeah.
Like I'm sitting in like a good class. Like, yeah. What is Golden? Like, why do we celebrate this every? Like, why am I off from school today?
Yeah, that's the thing where it's like, with my more advanced students, I like to engage in conversations because it's. I'm teaching them how I'm helping them practice their English through, you know, because that's what I'm a conversational English teacher. And so Golden Week gave me a lot of material to work with in terms of having conversations about this particular aspect of Japanese culture.
Are they receptive to you having conversations with them, or is it like pulling teeth? Because I know a lot of times when teachers try to like talk to students on like a one-on-one level, it becomes like a pulling teeth scenario.
Oh yeah.
Oh, they actually like the conversations.
Like respond to me.
They actually like the conversations, and for a while I tried to be more grammar focused, but then they would
texter.
They would ask me to be more more about the conversations than about the nitty-gritties of English grammar. And
yeah, they're like, shut the fuck up about the mechanics. We want to talk about Spider-Man.
finally, something about Japan I understand and can relate to. Lack of caring about grammar.
Oh, none of them are aware, none of my students of all ages, ranging from, like, kids to fucking 50, none of them are aware of Japanese Spider-Man.
Oh, now that's a crime.
That blew Japanese their Spider-Man, fucking minds.
But Japanese Spider-Man is best Spider-Man.
Because they don't give a fuck about tokusatsu here.
Ugh.
It's crazy.
Why are they still back again?
They're pumped
because
about Civil War,
they
though.
They want to sell toys to kids.
Are they pumped for Civil War, though? Like,
no. Like I said, no. like I mentioned before our conversation.
All of you are just like, no.
Why
no.
They
like,
have...
they know Spider-Man, they know Superman, but they don't know any other American superheroes.
They don't know Batman?
Oh, no. They think Batman's too scary, for those who do know
no
Batman.
No way, really?
They like Superman more than Batman here.
That's insanity. Wow. I did not know that.
And oh, Batman, he's too scary, too violent. Have you seen the shit your country has put out?
No, they haven't.
I was always under the impression that Batman was very popular in Japan.
No, not at all.
Ah, interesting.
He almost crossed over with Godzilla.
Yeah, was that?
They're not gonna know that.
That was fucking Sekizawa's idea back in the day.
They're not gonna know that. They're not nerds who are obsessed with their own shit like we are.
If they give such a little shit about their own pop culture, why do they have an entire week dedicated to part of their pop culture?
Oh, no, it's part, of that. Okay, so here's the thing. So, yeah, I asked them, and the majority of them are completely unaware of, like, the specifics of Golden Week. They just know it's a thing. They don't know why it's a thing to begin with. And so we would learn together. We would, like, do a little, like, look up on Wikipedia or Googling on our phone, or Google it on our phones. And we would learn together that... Or, you know, by bringing the collective information that I've gathered from each of my classes, Golden Week was created as a way of celebrating four holidays that just so happened to have been within a week of each other. So this past Friday was the first holiday, which is Showa Day, a day meant to celebrate the Showa period of Japanese history. The reason why we have Showa, period.
All of those movies.
the entire canon of the Godzilla franchise from 1954 to 1975.
And all the...
Primarily focusing on the first and last entry, because those are the best, debatably.
So the Showa period started from 1923 and ended in 1988. And the reason why we have the Showa period...
Oh, really?
Yes. And the reason...
I thought Showa ended at 80.
No, it was 88, because that was when the...
Yeah, that's
the
thing.
Reason why
that's
we have...
Return of Godzilla is technically a Showa film, if you want to be really...
Technically, yeah. So the reason why we have the Showa period is because of the Japanese emperor, Hirohito. So when he became emperor, that's when the Showa period began. And when he died, that's when the Showa period ended. At which point, Hirohito's son took over as the new emperor, and that started the Heisei era, which continues to this very day.
Oh,
and
Grace, how does it feel having an emperor like Star Wars? Like,
it feels the same because the emperor serves the same purpose as the Queen of England in England, where they don't have any real purpose. It's just there to carry on a tradition.
Yeah. Do they like
like our president?
Do they have weird looking red guards that go around with big sticks and never actually do anything?
I haven't seen the president. I haven't seen the emperor himself yet, Bill.
By the way,
is everything proceeded as he has foreseen?
Have we ever actually seen them do something?
What, the royal guards?
Oh, we saw them get knocked out by Yoda.
In the old EU, yeah.
No, fuck that.
No, it was like a whole thing where, like, you saw how they got trained. It was really cool. Damn it, why is it all gone?
What were they trained? What were they trained to do? How are they any
kick ass?
How are they not completely pointless?
Maybe those sticks are like lightsaber pikes.
No, see, they can stun people with their sticks. See, they're the most elite warriors at the Emperor's disposal, and their entire job is to just like protect him. Not that he really needs.
But he doesn't need protection.
The Emperor's force powers are not common knowledge. Like, he never uses it
No, I know.
In view of his subjects and shit. So, like,
no, I know, but I always thought that the guards were supposed to just be like a mask. Like, they were just supposed to be there because he's supposed to have bodyguards. They weren't actually any good. Like, they were just sort of there, and they relied on his force powers so that way they would never have to do their job. Like, that's what I always thought.
No, they're very elite soldiers. Actually, you know what? If you do want royal guard, some royal guards doing some shit, you can read the novel Lords of the Sith, in which. And this is canon. in which the Emperor and Darth Vader and two Imperial guards are stranded in the wilderness of the planet Ryloth and have to battle rebels and giant bug monsters and all sorts of fun shit like that.
All right, that sounds really interesting, but it also makes me upset because I just read a really fun Marvel comic crossover called Star Wars Vader Down, and it's the exact same fucking premise, just without the Emperor.
Well, this time the Emperor's there, which makes everything 10 times better. So.
Yeah, I mean, the comic is good. That sounds better, though, is the thing. That's why I'm upset.
But I guess anyways, sorry, guys.
Yeah. So, no.
There's this one scene. It's amazing. So, like, they're in the woods, right? And they come across this Twi'lek girl, because this is where the Twi'leks live. And apparently I've been mispronouncing this alien race's name my entire life. Apparently they're supposed to be called Twi'leks, but I'm like, no, fuck that. Twi'lek sounds better. Anyway, they meet a Twi'lek, and she takes them back to their village, because apparently these like, rustic Twi'lek people have this tradition where they have to, like, welcome all, like, outsiders that are, like, very friendly and shit. And, like, they don't know who the Emperor and Vader is, because they're, like, backwater hicks who, like, have no idea about what's going on in the greater universe around them. So they don't know who the fuck they've got there. So
they're like that guy from DBZ Abridged who showed Vegeta his Dragon Ball?
Yeah. So then the Emperor makes up, like, fake names for himself and Vader. That the villagers now...
Oh, God, what does he say Vader's name is?
I don't remember what the names are, but then it's explained in the text that those are actually ancient Sith words, and the name that he used for Vader is an ancient Sith word for, I think, destiny, but the cool part is the Emperor's ancient Sith word name means death.
Interesting. You think he thought about that in advance? Like, he was like, if anybody ever asks me for a fake name, I'm gonna tell them my name is Death. In old school Sith terminology.
And he already wears the trappings.
Makes sense. So, mm-hmm. Andres,
yes.
There is no millennium.
No. No, there is no millennium. The only reason
So, where does Shinsei come from then?
Is Shinsei, isn't that the Japanese word for millennium?
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, that would make sense. Yeah, all right.
Yes, but
I feel like such an idiot whenever I talk to you now.
The funny thing
I like that.
And
I used to feel smart when I talked to you.
Andres, is it currently the Shin period in Japan? Is that what's happening?
No, actually, it is the Anno period, for your information.
Oh, my mistake, yes.
But, yeah, I would share with my students that the reason why I was already familiar with Showa and Heisei is because I told them that American Godzilla and Tokusatsu fans use Showa and Heisei to differentiate the old material and the new material. And they were pretty shocked that America would be familiar, some Americans would be familiar with those Japanese terms. Then again, they are not aware of how popular their own shit is outside their country.
And they're not aware that people get tattoos of Godzilla on their body. That would fuck with them if I was like, I have a tattoo of the thing that you guys don't even care about, but it's from your country on my body.
Yeah.
And I have no regrets about it whatsoever.
No, I wouldn't be surprised if, like, there are a lot of Japanese people who are probably not even aware that Godzilla continues to be a thing, because with the some college students that I've talked to, some of the university students, like, a lot of them, of course, they're not Godzilla fans, because,
we act like they have some kind of obligation to know. They live their own lives.
I know that in Japan, I know that in general, but it's like, for them,
it's just weird.
They don't even think that Godzilla is relevant anymore. They just think of him as this old thing from a couple decades ago, even though there were still movies made up to 2004, and even a new movie just 2 years ago.
It's so weird to me, though. It would be like coming across an American who doesn't know who Superman is. Like really? Like you?
You know what though? You see that a lot these days, though. A lot of people don't like know the details of these characters. Ooh. They know that they like are they exist.
Like
they
Wonder
don't
Woman.
Know any of the details.
Like, most people know Wonder Woman, but they don't know like the Greek mythology behind her.
Oh yeah, none of them get that.
Oh, about her they think Wonder movie. Woman. Yeah, they know of invisible plane, robe, bracelets, Wonder Woman! And that's pretty much
it. You know what it is, too, though? It's also just, like, they don't even, like, think about the fact that there are details.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of them, it's, like, Superman. well, what's his origin story? It's like he has an origin story. Like they don't even think about that.
He's just a dude in tights and he flies and he's really strong.
The idea that Superman has to come from somewhere doesn't exist in people like that's mind. And it's just that they're not movie fans. They don't think about story and narrative.
Right.
And
exactly.
Profession. Things exist.
Absolutely.
First of all, that's a stupid question. Everybody has an origin story. It's just that most of ours involve like sweaty nights in the back of a Chevy. Not
Superman's did too, but it was like a weird space Chevy.
Not really planets exploding and like weird Jesus metaphors.
And flying worm things.
And computers that may or may not have blown up the planet. And
and a birthing matrix. Oh,
there's also that weird skull thing.
Yes.
Yeah, that thing.
Why was it a skull?
Because...
Metaphor?
Zack Snyder.
For what?
Because deep, symbolic meaning, pretentious shit?
Because, Bill, a symbol that we traditionally associate with death is the bastion of all Kryptonian life.
So if that's true, how come Superman is the man of tomorrow? Because you're gonna die in the future. Oh my gosh.
And he's the savior of Metropolis, which is the city of tomorrow, also.
The city of death. That makes a lot of sense at Man of Steel.
My god.
Anyway.
Anyways,
Zack Snyder's secretly brilliant.
That was one of my the comments I received on my review for Batman v Superman. It's like, actually, I think this movie's a lot deeper than anyone gives it credit for.
No, it is. It doesn't deserve to be analyzed that way.
Yeah. Look at all the really subtle messages when they drop the word God every 5 seconds.
Yeah, you remember when fucking... You remember that scene where Lex Luthor literally said he was Prometheus? I sure do.
Yeah. Well, you know... Kevin Spacey did the same thing in his Superman movie.
Every fucking character ever does that now when they're dealing with anybody with any kind of superpower.
Mm-hmm.
I've always wanted to see like a story like that take place in the Star Wars universe, where you just have a bunch of non-force sensitive people decide that they're tired of Jedi and Sith like fucking up their shit.
You have like an anti force user force?
Yeah.
Oh, you can call them the Force Graspers.
Force Busters?
No, fuck that. Force Graspers.
Come on. Who
are
you gonna holo vid? Force Busters.
All right, so we're about an hour and a half in.
Oh, okay.
So
I'll just quickly go through the last three holidays. On Tuesday.
Oh, no. Andres, I would rather talk about that. Mm-hmm. Go talk for as long as you want.
Okay.
And then however much time we have left, we'll determine what we're gonna do with the news then.
Okay then.
Because I'm enjoying this conversation.
Okay, so for the second holiday, which is on a Tuesday, that is Constitution Memorial Day. And that is the day celebrated for that moment in time, kind of the day that made to celebrate the birth of post-war Japan in 1948, where after like Japan got completely fucked up after World War II and was forced to surrender, much their economy was complete shit at that point. I think it was America that came in and helped them reestablish themselves and become a lot more modernized, and they got a new constitution.
We destroyed them, and then after we destroy people, we tend to go back in and be like, here, let me help you out a lot.
Yeah.
We're real nice like that. We blow up their capital cities, and then we help them rebuild them afterward. It's real nice.
By the way, I'm always nervous about talking about World War II with these people, because
of course.
It seems like they like to hide a lot of this information from the students themselves. First off, they teach their students about World War II in sixth grade. Never go back to covering it after sixth grade. So I'm thinking they probably teach them so early so that they can forget about it once they become teenagers.
Sixth grade isn't that early though. I would remember if I was taught about that in sixth grade. I mean, I learned about World War II way before that. But
just remember, Andre.
I would remember that. I mean, you guys don't remember sixth grade?
I remember most of my government shit in middle school.
Well, government, I'm not talking about government, though.
But no, like, history, proper history, yeah.
Yeah, we go.
What over... about like social studies and shit? You didn't take that in like first grade?
The thing about
I think it was fourth grade where I started learning about Mexican history, like the conquistadors and the Spaniards coming to America.
The thing about American history.
Wow.
The thing about American history is we have so much less of it than most other countries.
That's true.
That we sort of teach the same shit over and over again, and
that's the thing.
And then
that's
every
the
now
problem.
And then we're like, hey, world history, we'll teach you about that for a semester. But then the rest of the time, it's like, hey, Columbus, remember him? And we're like.
I swear to God, if I ever have to take another American history class again, I'm gonna fucking cut somebody's fucking face off. By the way, again, apologies for being so aggressive tonight. I don't know what happened to me.
Andres, here's the thing. Yes. Hey, you have sort of a responsibility that I don't know if you've grasped yet, because you're sort of like, you're an American in Japan. You know, you sort of represent our country in a way. And, I just wanted to make sure you remember the cover story that it was not us who bombed them. It was the government and where.
But here's the thing, they don't teach them in school. They don't teach them about Pearl Harbor. They don't never mention...
Or about South Park.
It's time
they don't mention that they were kind of the ones that got us into World War II.
Oh, so they're all about the part, they bombed us, but they don't ever go into the part where, we kind of bombed them first.
They fucked up our shit.
It's like... It's really a touchy subject talking to them about...
Well, to be fair, they didn't attack a civilian population.
Right, exactly. We did a really shitty thing to them.
Oh, no. To be fair, what we did was so much worse than what they did to us.
To be fair, we teach a pretty biased version of our history as well. I mean,
ours is probably worse than theirs.
Out to fucking Texas and read some of their textbooks, and it's like, in 1492, Jesus and Moses established America. And it's like,
because Andres, do you think that their history books are in any way influenced by us?
I honestly don't know. I mean, I know they harbor
in the 50s, probably.
I know they do not. Yes, I get it. They do not harbor any hatred towards
sure
us, especially the younger generation who honestly don't give a shit about history.
Because that generation is kind of. I mean, if they're not dead, then they really don't remember, probably.
Yeah, maybe the older generations, they still harbor some animosity towards America, but it's like. Really, they don't care. It's like, what happened isn't happened in the past, and I would agree that it was a shitty thing that shouldn't have happened. And it's like, we can agree on that.
I think everybody has the same opinion about World War II, though, which is the bombing
was
horrible.
But then again, it's the whole thing. It's like you were allies to the Nazis. How do you feel about that?
Well, and you look at what they did in Manchuria, and then you look at the fact that if we hadn't bombed them when we did, we may have been looking at an extended conflict. It's a complex issue.
I wrote a paper on it at one point. I fucking know that it's a complex issue.
Yeah, yeah.
But everybody is kind of on the same page of it being a complex issue.
But it's very important that we had dropped the bomb when we did, because
Truman did the right thing. He did the only thing he could possibly do.
Somebody had to be the first person to do it, and whoever the first person to do it probably was going to wind up being on top for the rest of the 20th century, and look how that worked out for us.
We'll see how it ends, because... It'll end.
Oh, we're definitely on the downswing now.
Oh, we are fucked in the next couple of years. It's so obvious. Mm-hmm. People hate us overseas.
Moving to Canada any day now, as long as they don't get the wall up.
I really hope. See, I've talked about this a lot recently. I really want to move to Australia. That's kind of my dream, because I love that country so much.
Mm-hmm.
It's never going to happen, though. They're never going to let me in, because I do not have the health for it. They'll take one look at my medical exam and go... You're not going anywhere near our way.
You would have a better chance of coming to Japan, because Japan is Japan is really strict on immigration. But if you're from a primarily white country like Australia, England, or America, you have a much easier time than anyone else.
Yeah, because the problem with Australia is they have a really specific ecosystem and a specific biodiversity. And if you fuck it up...
It's hot and there are poisonous snakes and a dingo eats your baby. It's not fun.
Exactly.
It's not a fun time.
If you fuck it up, then whatever. Bad things will happen. Now, that's weird, though, because Australia does... You're right. It also has, like, fucking insanely amount of fucking invasive wildlife. Like, dingoes are they're an invasive species, aren't they?
I'm not sure. I know...
I can ask my new Australian friend about that next time.
I know that they have a huge rabbit problem.
Yeah, the rabbits were a problem. But I think the dingoes... This might be a joke I'm remembering that I'm fucking thinking is an actual historical fact. I think they actually introduced the dingoes to get rid of the rabbits.
Hmm.
I don't think dogs were a natural thing in Australia.
They weren't anticipating getting rid of their babies. Unfortunate side effect.
Oh, and then cane toads, of course. Cane toads fucked up Japan real, fucked up Australia real bad.
Isn't there a problem with cane toads in like parts of Florida too? Where like
that was a thing like fucking 12 years ago.
Dogs would eat them and then die because they're poisonous. And, like...
Well, yeah, like the big problem was, I remember I saw a PSA about this once. There was a fucking cane toad sitting on somebody's fucking poolside in somebody's backyard. And there was a baby just, like, crawling towards it, and it cut right when the baby picked up the cane toad.
Ugh.
And the idea was that it stuck the cane toad in its mouth. And that was, like, a concern. That was a genuine concern at the time, that you would fucking pick up a cane toad. And...
People like to have exotic pets, but the thing is, when your exotic pet gets out in the wild, it can fuck up the local ecosystem. So what I'm saying is...
I mean, Florida has that to the extreme.
You're
going to
have an exotic pet. Be prepared to kill it rather than let it escape.
I mean, Florida, I mean, pythons...
Or be sure to neuter it.
Pythons are an established species in Florida now. That is so fucked. Like, in the past 10 years that so many pythons have escaped from people's captivity and everything, and so many have escaped from zoos and so many other different places during hurricanes and everything, that they are an established species in Florida.
I'll be interested.
They just exist.
I'll be interested to see where the resurrected mammoth species winds up settling down.
Probably wherever you live, Dylan. Tennessee. I can't believe I forgot that for a second. I'm a dickhead.
That'd be great. I would love to try a mammoth burger.
We did a whole podcast about a word.
All right. So, Constitution Memorial Day. So that's a holiday made to celebrate or pay respect to the day when that new constitution was developed and caused a huge reform across Japan and allowed it to modernize and establish the new post-war Japanese economy that continues to flourish to this day. From what I understand.
That made me think of something. Maybe the way that the Japanese should handle teaching World War II to their students is if they just had a fucking two-page book. It's like a comic book. It's like a two-page spread.
Mm-hmm.
Black background, white text. It just says, in regards to World War II, it's complicated.
I always wonder how countries like go about. Like, how do German history teachers?
What my friends tell me, they do not want. They never teach the Nazi portion of their German history.
Like. See,
that's so weird though, because you'd think they'd be like, let's not do this again.
I mean, we learn about like slavery and the Civil War and that shit.
Yeah, no. Yeah, but you know what though? You fuckers didn't live in the North when we went through that shit, because in the North we were like, oh well, it wasn't us.
That's bullshit, because there were slaves in the North.
It absolutely is bullshit.
Time.
Yeah.
Not the whole time, but there were.
No, for less time, for we had them for less than you did. We were more in line with England. We were like, 200 years.
We had cotton we needed to pick, and you know.
Yeah, no, Dylan, we know. We all know you had your
experience. What's really funny is that, like, we are aware that America has fucked over a lot of countries over the decades.
I mean, listen. All children, like, in kindergarten are very delicately introduced to the fact that we once committed genocide on a race of people who lived here. Originally.
You see, I disagree though. I think that's something that doesn't come up until like sixth grade, like we were saying before. I think that the Native American side of it is something that is very much so treated with some embarrassment in America. I think that's like our World War II, even more so than slavery,
mm-hmm.
because I think it's kind of worse. I think it is worse. I mean, we literally committed genocide.
And shoved them into a bunch of unbearable reservations.
Had they... It's really fucked up, because if they had been more useful as slaves, they wouldn't be on reservations.
That's the thing.
We tried to use them as slaves, and they couldn't do it. That's why we had to import the...
You want to know why?
The Africans.
Because they were too fucking good as warriors. That's not fully.
If you're from fucking Africa, you can deal with some heat. That's what you need to be a slave, especially around here. Jesus Christ.
Point being, I think that the native, because the thing, what I was saying was, the way they introduce it is they're like, we made a shady deal with them. We fucked them over. We took some beads and we gave them some blankets with some smallpox in it.
In exchange for the nation.
As it, yeah. And the way that school teachers initially treat that reveal of, like, we gave them beads and blankets with smallpox on them is like, we did it by accident. Our bad. We didn't think about it. We didn't think that the blankets would kill them. But then you get to, like, ninth grade, and they're like, oh, by the way, that was the beginning of germ warfare.
Yeah, we were, like, rubbing plates.
It's like, what the fuck, man? How come I didn't throw in that shit in sixth grade? That's so
fucked. And they're way harsher. They're way harsher when they talk about conquistadors, but at least the conquistadors just, like, fucked the natives and, like, interbred with them.
Yeah.
And produced me.
And we tried. It didn't go too well.
So they were Spanish, and they were less racist than we were. We came over here, and we're like, get out of here, you.
Well, they kind of fucked over, like, several entire Latin American empires in the process.
Yeah, I mean, the conquistadors committed genocide, too.
They pretty much wiped out a good portion of the Aztecs and the Mayans and all of the Incans, maybe, stuff.
At the end of the day, they didn't put all the brown people in a small area and, like, keep the rest.
I mean, they didn't. No. They weren't as. They
we
weren't
took
as,
our
like,
country back, damn it.
They weren't as overt or specific about it as we were. Mm-hmm. Like, the way that they came off about it, it comes off as almost. Again, that to me almost comes off like an accident. Like, it comes off like fucking one of those conquistadors because just got too drunk one night and just killed one too many. For Columbus and all that, it seems like a calculated fucking move.
They had,
you know what I'm
they
saying?
They had more reason to go all ape shit and kill the natives. They had, like, the Aztecs rolling heads down steps and shit. What did we?
Well, they also, well,
we
they
had
also
a,
had fucking.
We had a bunch of fucking hippies just, like, smoking weed and shooting buffalo. Like, we had very.
We had a fucking competent, well put together, and peaceful society on this fucking on this continent, in this country. And meanwhile, down south, they're fucking chopping heads off and shit.
Yeah, but
you know what else?
We had a bigger city with giant monuments and
you
statues
guys were more
and temples. Yeah.
You guys were definitely more advanced.
Depending on.
But you also had gold, remember?
Depending on the.
And chocolate. We had cocoa beans.
And sugar cane.
Yes. You're welcome.
That's cool. I appreciate it, Andres. Thanks
yeah.
for your zero.
Yeah, Andres will we smoke them peace pipe.
Anyways, to yeah. wrap up.
Oh, wait. Yeah, you guys were cocaine. Damn. Jesus. Didn't cocaine come from South America? Didn't they, like, chew the leaves, like, for pain?
Yeah, I think heroin did, too.
Probably. But,
I'm so ashamed.
Anyways, the third holiday, which is on the Wednesday, is what they call Green Day, which is essentially America's Earth Day, giving, not a celebration of the American band for whatever reason. Maybe they just like to sing about American idiots.
You see, maybe we just witnessed a generation gap just there, even though I'm younger than you guys, because when you said Green Day, I thought of the Earth thing first, and then I thought of the band. I was like, oh yeah, there's a fucking band called Green Day, and I have one of their songs in my Spotify playlist. I don't know why. But I do.
And the last holiday on the...
What do you guys think of... Wait, hang on. What do you guys think of Green Day?
I have no
idea. Right. The singer has an awfully high-pitched voice that's difficult to replicate.
I don't know. What's the song that they sing? I don't know. And like...
Was it September?
When September ends. Yeah.
When September ends.
Oh, that...
Yeah, that was their big one.
Oh, that whiny fuck. Yeah.
Yeah, American Idiot, of course, is their big one. That's the most
American
Idiot. Yeah, I like that one.
Johnny Test ripped them the fuck off.
Oh yeah.
They're fine.
And finally, did they make a cameo in the Simpsons movie, singing the Simpsons theme song?
Yeah, they did, didn't they?
Yeah. Well, anyways,
I feel like we were just making fun of that specific scene just there, because that I think that scene is them going da 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 da
da da da. Yeah, basically it. And he's reading from a prompter. He's reading da 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 da.
That's wow! You're taking me back to my fucking youth, man. I haven't seen that movie in years, but yeah, that's right.
I wonder if any of their pop culture references would still hold up in this day and age.
The Simpsons movie?
Not where you live.
Well, certainly not the Simpsons themselves.
Well, anyways, and the final holiday on Thursday is Children's Day. And I think what they do is, have you ever seen those, like, Japanese images of, like, these kites that look like they're in the shape of fishes?
Yeah.
That's
like Magikarp.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, yeah. I think it's based off, I think it's a Japanese legend where you have these fishes that jump into some magical waterfall and they turn into dragons. Hence why we have Magikarp that evolves into Gyarados in Generation 1 of Pokemon.
I just want to point out that the English teacher is saying fishes.
Yeah, damn. You and your fucking homophones and all that bullshit.
Anyways.
You and your fancy book learners.
Anyways,
have you taught them plurals yet? Have you taught them about the fishes and the mooses and the deerses?
Oh, I taught them how plurals are complete nonsense in the English language. How it's like, for some, it's as easy as putting an S in front of a noun. Other times you put an ES. Other times you change the entire fucking word in and of itself from mouse to mice.
Yeah.
Andres.
Yeah.
Have you told them about Moosley yet?
No, I have not told them about Moosley yet, Bill.
Dude, you need to have a whole class on Moosley.
I don't know that that's a thing that needs to happen.
Anyways, so yeah, for Children's Day, a lot of families would set up those like fish kites in their houses, like next to their set up those fish kites and tie them to their houses. So, yeah, and the reason, so those are the four holidays that make up Golden Week. And the reason why we have Golden Week is because a lot of businesses, in America, we have several, if you have, like, you work for a business and you get to have, like, a limited number of paid vacation days. And in Japan, they do have that as well, but they normally save them for specific times of the year. And I can get into that in another episode of SOS. But because they dedicate themselves so much to work and they don't ask for a day off and they don't ask for people to cover their own shifts, they essentially, you know, overwork themselves. So the government said, you know what, let's have Golden Week.
Is that true?
What?
What you just said, that they collectively as a nation, they were like, we don't want a day off.
Exactly. Yeah, it's too much work to, and we don't want to ask people to cover for us. For just so we can have a day off.
Wow, that's insanity. So, what is this culture of people who try to benefit society?
It's an entire nation of like overly polite people. Andres, you should have moved there.
Overly polite and overly worked people.
You really are perfect for that goddamn country. You know that.
And so they decided to, you know, let's just give everyone an entire week. Some people still work on, depending on what business you work in. It's kind of like, you know, like. For any sort of national holiday in America where there are still going to be some businesses that are going to be open during holidays. And so that is essentially why we have Golden Week, to give everyone a break for both children and adults alike.
That is so fucking
wild. In other words, what you're saying is you're free for a week.
Exactly. I actually have no work this coming week.
Wow.
Yeah. So hopefully I do.
You want to come over and chill?
I might be planning like on going to Nagoya for the first time to see like a big Japanese city for the first time.
Is this is this like spring break in America, or do they have that as well?
Their spring break is our summer break. Spring break represents the beginning and end of the school year.
Right. Yeah. Because I remember, fucking. Godzilla versus Megaguirus. Bringing that movie up again. I don't know why. Well, I'll tell you why.
I think you just triggered Andrew, who's listening right now.
Oh, I hope so.
Trigger warnings. Trigger warnings all around.
Trigger your timbers. In that movie, that was how I learned that fact about Japan, that they have like their spring break is like our summer break, and that on TV when you're introduced to the kid character, you see two characters and they're just like, oh, it's spring, kids. It's 2 months off from school. And I'm like, spring break? 2 months off from school? Who are these lucky motherfuckers? And I would be actually on spring break watching that movie as a kid. And like, I only have like fucking 2 days off. Fuck you.
And, let's see. They do eventually have a summer break, but it's a lot shorter. And the reason why they get a summer break is, oh, it's too hot to focus on studying.
oh, we're all literally going to drop dead if we don't fucking go home. But, gotcha.
Hey, that's my excuse.
We're too polite to not drop dead, though, so I don't know, what are we going to do?
They don't have a fall break.
What about winter? Do they do anything in the winter?
They have 2 weeks for... two weeks for winter break. But for businesses, they only get 1 week off for New Year's, because to here in Japan, Christmas is not a national an official like national holiday.
Yeah, I was about to ask, do they the Christmas in Japan?
Yeah, they do the Christmas, but it's the same way how we do the Halloween, where Halloween it's not technically a national holiday.
I think that's going to change in America soon, by the way, because Halloween's becoming bigger, like almost as big as Christmas. Yeah,
Thanksgiving is disappearing altogether, and like...
Well, a lot of people have turned on Thanksgiving because, you know, like all that genocide shit we were talking about earlier, so bring that back.
That popular turkey topic.
Think about all the turkey and human blood spilled.
Next thing you know, Trump is like, the liberals are trying to take our Thanksgiving. I'm gonna go against this. I'm gonna make the biggest Thanksgiving ever. I'm gonna cook it. Wife is gonna be beautiful. Turkey is gonna be huge.
See, what I love about Andres' Donald Trump impression is that I can't tell if it's supposed to be Jerry Seinfeld or Donald Trump
with Donald Trump?
What's the deal with putting the wall up? Why won't Mexico pay for it? It's going to be huge.
It sounds very similar. The only difference is like you put your intonation is a little different from one to the other.
With Trump, you got to sound like a stealing animal, and
you punctuate every sentence with "It's going to be huge."
It's going to be huge.
You gotta talk like this. You gotta get down there. You gotta be like, "Hey, let's talk about some Muslims. I don't want them in my country. Yeah, it's going to be huge in my country. Yeah. It'll make it great.
I'm going after this rally to purchase a new toupee. It's going to be huge."
China.
Word. All right, Andres. All right, if there's nothing else that an American Mexican did in Japan this week.
Yeah.
I think we should move on to the shit that people may or may not care about with Andres Perez. But before we do...
Well, I climbed the mountain. I climbed the mountain yesterday.
Oh, fuck! I forgot about you climbing the mountain. So let's talk about that. Fuck the news. What happened? Did you see Japanese Bigfoot? Whatever it's called? Because that exists. It is Japanese. I forget what it's called.
Like, he's real, damn it!
He's out there! So what happened? What'd you do?
Did you get eaten by Gyra?
No, I did not. But I could have sworn I saw my friends were driving through the tunnel that went a traffic tunnel that went through the mountain. I could have sworn I saw Baragon wrestling some bikers.
Awesome. And they threatened to take me to the hospital if I said it again. So I just decided not to.
Right, right. And my friends and I agreed never to speak of it again. But other than that. Yeah, it was pretty awesome. I mean, I felt like dying the entire time because I have never like hiked before. Not hiked. It's been like year. I can't even remember the last time I hiked this much. But it's like I think everyone was trying to cover up the fact that they were tired by giggling or laughing or joking. Meanwhile, I'm like cursing. I'm sweating.
You were the traditional American.
He's definitely the American in the group. Leave it to exercise to bring out Andres' Americanness.
I love it. He's just fucking spitting and fucking...
Why'd you want
Japanese mountains and shit. Like, fucking American mountains.
However,
I
ended up getting to the top before the majority of them, because even though a lot of them are like very skinny and slim, they get tired really easily. And I just like...
Also leave it for it to bring out the competitive side of Andres.
Powered on through.
They're living also, on... Also... You have like reserves of American food still built up in your system.
I guess so.
You got a backlog of fucking... Whatever those fucking things from Taco Bell are that you and Dylan like that I forget the name of. Quesalupa, is that what it's called?
That's one of them. Grilled stuffed burrito. Double XL grilled stuffed burrito.
Yeah, I can't stand you. Every fucking one of my friends, including you two, loves Taco Bell.
And no, right? It's the opposite for me. Everyone hates Taco Bell. I'm the only one who likes it.
Oh, we should switch friends then. You know what? Yeah, let's do that.
You don't understand, man. It's like crack. You gotta have it.
Oh, I feel that.
But,
not
Jones. Anyways, If any of you are friends of mine on Facebook, you can see the pictures I posted up there where it's like the top view of the mountain is so beautiful. You can see the entirety of Gifu, and then like off into the distance, you can see Nagoya, and it's just absolutely breathtaking. You can see the entire city is surrounded by mountains, green, luscious green mountains. It's just like breathtaking. And yeah, I had like an amazing time yesterday doing that on the actual day of my birthday, according to the Japanese time zone.
You would not catch me. Right. You would not catch me hiking up no damn mountain. I'll tell you that much.
All right.
Our ancestors did not spend thousands of years building civilization for me to hike up a mountain.
Even though, Dylan, there is literally a week every year where you go walk a mountain.
I don't actually walk. Like you drive on a highway and you.
So you're a mountain driver as opposed to a mountain walker.
I mean, and when I do actually like go up on the mountain to like see the view or whatever, I'm in a fucking tram. There's no hiking involved. I do it like an American.
And that's what makes you better than this other piece of shit over here. Nah. but I have a weird question for you.
Yeah.
It's not that weird. I guess it's a little weird. What kind of wildlife do you see on a regular basis over there?
Mostly bugs. Yeah, bugs.
What about birds?
I see. One of my friend Jonathan was talking about the crows.
Have you captured a wild Kyoto yet?
The crows here are like ridiculously huge. They will like fuck up our American crows, and they
really
and they're a lot bigger, and they sound so weird because they don't do a screechy caw, caw sound. They actually vocalize. They sound like people going ah ah.
Oh, I've heard. They're like the crows, like they used. You guys ever see Crocodile Dundee?
No.
Like Australian crows, like they sound. Yeah, they sound like you hear it in Australian movies all the time, like that. That's what it is.
Yeah,
it's
a
crow. They're horrible animals. I hate them. Crows are the worst birds.
American crows, especially.
They're the worst. I think crows are worse than pigeons because crows are more aggressive.
I think wild Pidgeotos are definitely the worst that you can come up with.
Do you have a fucking Master Ball, Dylan?
You don't want to waste a Master
Ball. I don't
want to
waste that on a Pidgeotto, motherfucker.
See, this is where I show my lack of knowledge about Pokemon.
You better save that
for
a Zapdos.
There's only one Master Ball per game.
Really?
Yeah, there's only one in existence unless you do some sort of special event or some weird...
That shit. You better save that
Yeah, yeah.
For a Lugia
generally,
or
there's like
Rayquaza
one best.
Or whatever the fuck the biggest.
Yeah, yeah. Or Mewtwo or whatever.
And if you fail this with the Master Ball, then you're fucked, because then you gotta try and capture the thing with regular Pokeball.
Yeah, no, the Master Ball is a 100%. You will capture it, like a 100% chance of capturing it.
I see.
Yeah. Oh,
I feel like such a loser now.
You never waste your Master Ball on a fucking Pidgey.
How can I be so silly?
One of the most common Pokemon in the games.
I feel like such a nerd for not knowing that.
You fucking asshole.
Oh, alright. Oh, now who's getting aggressive?
You better wise up.
Shit.
You better wise up, Bill. Get yourself some regular Pokeballs. Learn Cut. You're gonna need that. Go out there in the world.
I will literally not. If fucking Professor Oak was like, you're gonna go out and catch some Pokemon, I'd be like, I'd rather not. I'm gonna go home and jerk off and watch Dragon Ball Z. That's my life.
You
today.
Have an army of supernatural animals that have to do your bidding.
But I don't. You have to fucking kill them. Now you don't have to kill them, but you have to beat them up first until they agree to do it.
Yes, that's the point.
At that point, that sounds like flirting with girls, and I have enough difficulty with that as it is.
But then once you beat the shit out of that dragon,
that dragon
will immediately respect you and say, this guy kicked my ass.
Well, if only if it was so easy with women. What?
Question your logic. Beating up a Pokemon is like hitting on girls.
Think about it.
You reverted to the caveman days. You come out of your house carrying a big club, and you're like, I think I'll have rape for breakfast.
Is this why I'm wanted in so many states, and why I was when I left California, they were like, yeah, don't ever come back.
Maybe.
Well, maybe you're just high as giraffe pussy, and you don't know what you're saying. You're just talking.
What? What did he just say to me?
I don't know.
All right. That was awkward. Okay.
The news?
Let's do that.
All right. Okay. So let's see.
The question I was going to ask you before is how many stories do you have?
Ooh. Okay. Let's see. I have collected quite a bit. I just want to mention like a couple of them just in passing. One, Punisher. It's confirmed that Punisher is going to have his own spin-off Netflix series.
I'm about it.
Let's see. Doctor Strange. Do you remember? You grew up with watching the movie reviews of Spill.com. Remember, Bill?
Yeah.
Okay, remember one of them? His name was Carlisle.
Yeah.
He is one of the writers for Doctor Strange.
No way!
Yeah.
That's so dope.
And his real
name... I love Carlisle. He was awesome.
His real name is Robert C. Cargill, and he was the writer of a recent horror movie from a couple years back. But he was able to, because due to his connection with Corey Coleman's new website, Double Toasted. He went on Double Toasted to break the news as to why one of the characters who was Doctor Strange characters who was originally a male Tibetan, the ancient one basically. Turned the ancient one white? We never talked about this because honestly, I didn't know who the ancient one was until after we recorded that episode, the last episode of SOS. But there's a lot of controversy saying, oh, why did they make the ancient one white? Oh, it's Hollywood whitewashing. And he went on Double Toasted, and that podcast.
Played by Scarlett Johansson. Jesus fucking.
what was it? What was her name?
Tilda Swinton.
Tilda Swinton. Yes, that's who's playing the ancient one. And they mentioned that basically it all boiled down to international marketing, where it's like if they did kept the character Tibetan or if they made a character from Tibet. Then, you know, they would lose a lot of, the Chinese government would disapprove, saying, oh, the ancient one? You're saying, this super awesome Asian character is from Tibet? Well, we're not going to have this movie in China. And then you're going to lose 25% of your total worldwide, income. Because China matters that much in the grand scheme of things when it comes to making movies overseas. And they're like, oh. And he explained, you cannot... you cannot simply make, they did ask, can't you simply make the ancient one just another Asian race, like Chinese? And he said, I would love to I would love to work with a Chinese actress and do stuff like that. But Carlisle or Robert C. Cargill was like, then you get into a whole other mess where it's like, you're going to have a lot of people going after you saying, oh, how dare you change a character from Tibet and make her, him or her Chinese? What, you think all Asians look alike? Or it doesn't matter what Asian race you pick, you're going to upset some people over in that territory. So they figured,
so why even bother
that? Exactly. That's why they changed the race to white, because that's going to be, in the long run, that is going to be the choice.
People still got upset, though.
Right, but in the long run, they're going to receive the least amount of financial and critical backlash. So
they're doing the same. It's the same reason I had to fuck up the Mandarin Iron Man 3. I long for the days when Hollywood could just piss off Asia and not give a shit. You know,
it's not even the pissing off of Asia thing.
Breakfast at Tiffany days. You could just fucking take Mickey.
Oh God!
So it's really weird because a lot of times you would add Asian characters to appeal to the Asian demographic, but here there's an opposite problem of trying to avoid pissing off the Asian demographic by just not touching it at all whatsoever and having a white character instead.
Even if you have an Asian character and you don't specify what country they're from, the people in Asia can actually tell by looking. I don't know how.
Yeah.
Also,
remember what happened to the remake of Red Dawn? Where it's like they made a remake of Red Dawn.
Yeah, they couldn't do Korea because the Koreans are
right.
Like...
But they already filmed the movie, so they digitally went in and said, "Oh, these Koreans, yeah, they're actually Chinese." And everyone got upset, like, "Oh, how dare you make the North Koreans and treat them like Asians? Like you think they look the same?"
No. Didn't they change it from China to North Korea?
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah, sorry. That's what I mean.
Yeah, because I remembered that from from all those years back. Yeah.
Okay, I had it that back. Is the movie that the North Koreans made a big stink about.
We all remember that. We were doing the podcast at that time, remember?
Yeah.
We talked about that on the news. So, yeah, listen, here's my thought process on this. It doesn't matter, because that character has... The fact that character is Asian in the comics doesn't matter. It's a being. He's an interdimensional mystical being.
You know what? It's owned by Disney.
He's not actually a Tibetan man. Like, he looks like that because that's what... That's, he did that to blend into, like, the area, it seems like. Again, this is based, I know nothing about Doctor Strange. This is based on what I've heard from people who seem to know what they're talking about. So, this is my interpretation. So,
I mean, they could replace the ancient one with Yoda at this point, and I would, actually, that would be really cool.
That would be awesome. But the ancient one could look like Yoda if you wanted to, is what I'm saying. So, the fact that the ancient one looks like Tilda Swinton probably doesn't matter. Like, the fact that the ethnicity and gender probably has no bearing on what the character actually is what I'm saying. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Or either that, or maybe it's a fucking, maybe it's a mantle that's passed down, so maybe there was, like, an old-school-looking ancient one. I don't know.
Yeah.
But bearing that in mind, so not minding it, because, again, I don't care. I just hope the movie's good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, at the same time, I'm also just like, when are we going to get past all this archaic marketing stuff? Because I get why they think that it matters,
mm-hmm.
but it doesn't.
It's all about the power of the mighty dollar.
I get that, but I think it's a non-issue. I genuinely do. I think that if you make a good movie,
here's the thing. If you upset China, China could easily put a block on all future Marvel Studio movies.
But how many movies?
And all future Paramount or Disney movies.
How many movies in the past, though, Bill, have been actually really good but, like, flopped because they don't get marketed? Like, I don't think it's fair to say that it's a non-issue. And if you're one of these people who's invested like $50 million in making a movie, you're not going to shrug it off and be like, "Ah, don't worry about the marketing."
But I'm just saying, but with a franchise like that, I think it's a bit of a non-issue. I mean, it's not a franchise yet, but it's part of a franchise. I think it's a non-issue just because it's something that doesn't really matter anymore in the growing culture that we are in now. And to continue to act like it does matter is only going to make it last longer. Like I think we're getting to a world where stuff like this is not going to matter. This archaic marketing shit, and I think that the more we sort of put the spotlight on it, just sort of worse it gets. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm trying to say?
I think
we're building to a world where this doesn't matter.
Here's the thing. That's true, Dylan. But like, here's the thing. Like, you know, there's that stereotype that almost every Asian race hate each other. That is true.
Yeah, it's not.
Yeah, I get that.
Watch a Bruce Lee movie. It's not a stereotype.
I don't know. I don't know all the details. I'm just speaking my mind. I would like it to not matter because it's fucking dumb.
Right, it is. Yeah, but unfortunately, that is the stupid world.
That's
that
what I'm
in.
Saying is that it should matter because it's dumb.
Yeah.
And the fact that people are making decisions based on millions of dollars for all this is why it's so dumb. That's my thought. But
yeah.
I get it. I guess that's why I could never do it for a living. It's so dumb.
I can find that kind of refreshing about these Asian cultures. They hate each other openly, and none of them feel bad about it. White people can't hate. White people can't hate anybody without feeling bad about it later.
Well, I don't think
how
the
open,
Japanese.
How open and direct is it really, Andres? Though, because
no, they're not direct.
Cultures.
Like I said, like
no,
the,
that's
like I said
that's,
before,
that's the
Japanese are the opposite of confrontational. They won't like actively voice their displeasure at the Chinese.
But that doesn't speak for how the other Asian people might react, might act. You know, the Chinese. I mean, I've never been to China, but for all we know, they might be very open about it.
You know what I forgot? And this is my bad.
That China and Japan are two totally different countries.
Well, yes, but I forgot that how quick and easily China banned stuff. That was my bad, because I just remembered that they banned Deadpool. Deadpool didn't come out in China.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, that actually makes a lot more sense now. That's more understandable that Marvel wants to keep that market open.
There's another country in Japan. A country in Japan. There's another country in Asia. I don't remember which one. But, like, they have, like, a committee that's, like, entire job is to determine what entertainment is, like, moral. And, like, everybody in the general population hates this committee. It's like imagine if the FCC in our country was, like, had way more power than it actually does and was, like, super strict about everything. Like, the way they're portrayed in that one old episode of Family Guy. Like, imagine if that's actually how they were.
Well, it's like how before we had the Motion Pictures Association of America, I forget what it was called. Was it the Hayes Code? I think it was the Hayes Code.
Like the old archaic, like,
yes, it was.
Yeah. The old school film censorship, yeah. It's like, oh, churches are getting together to talk about whether or not Dracula is okay to be released in theaters. It's like,
yeah.
Why does your opinion matter? But it's did, like, back
you
in
got,
the day.
You gotta promote morals, and if you were gonna have a movie that focuses on gangsters, everyone has to be punished.
Exactly, yeah.
And we have to show the punishment.
Is that still a thing?
I mean, yeah, Walter White has to die at the end of Breaking Bad.
Well, I knew Walter White, but but universally, I mean. Because I've recently watched John Q. You guys ever seen John Q with Denzel Washington?
No.
Interesting is that if you watch Pulp Fiction, John Travolta is quite content to remain in the gangster life, and he winds up dead, whereas Samuel L. Jackson, who decides to get out of it, goes off to walk the earth.
Oh, so that's kind of
Maybe it's more of a narrative thing.
Well, I mean, listen, it's twofold. It's obviously a morality thing of, like, you don't want to give the impression that, you know, crime pays, because it usually doesn't. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it often does, though. You also, story-wise, it's hard to like people who are criminals because they enjoy that lifestyle. So usually what we need when we follow a character who does criminal things is we need them to be doing it for a reason that makes sense to us.
Mm-hmm.
So then, like, they have to be like your Walter White, where they're sort of forced into it, and then over the course of it, they're sort of seduced by the power.
I don't know. If you look at an example like Clockwork Orange, and maybe this is just a testament to the genius of Kubrick, he makes you root for the terrible things that go on in that film.
Yeah, but isn't the idea supposed to be that they're operating under a crew? I've never seen A Clockwork Orange, to be honest. I'm not really sure about the exact stipulations of the story, but isn't the idea supposed to be that they're under a corrupt government who doesn't understand, like, the fact that they have mental issues? Or isn't that supposed to be the idea?
It's a part of it, but before that even comes into the plot, all you have is, like, these street thugs running around, like, raping people and, like, it's and having getting into street fights with other people, and it really is. I think most of it is the performance from Malcolm McDonald, or McDonald. What's his name? McDowell. McDowell.
Yeah, that's it.
Fucking late or early.
Malcolm McDonald. Yeah, we had a farm.
I'm dying here.
It's actually early. But anyway, Malcolm McDowell.
Exactly.
It's because of his performance, I think. But you actually do sort of get drawn into that character's, like, headspace in a way, in a creepy way, actually. Like, you walk away from the movie, like, questioning your own sanity a little bit. Like, did I really just for him to rape that woman?
And I think that's the idea. But I think even with stuff like that, you have to still kind of, you still have to show that. I don't know, you still have to make people relatable. So I'm sure that there are, again, not having seen it, I'm sure there are elements of those characters that are relatable, you know what I mean? Like, in a sense of, like, they do stuff and say stuff that is meant to make the audience go, okay, well, these people act enough like real people that I know. That I can sort of follow them along even through all these horrible things that they're doing, as long as I understand the context of it.
I suppose you could make an argument for that they are relatable in a way, in that they blatantly act out on the sort of more violent urges that most people repress, but we all are aware are there.
Yeah, I think that's maybe the idea, that people wish that they could go off and do that.
Yeah.
I don't know. I appreciate that. I don't know what we were talking about, but I'm sure it was interesting and compelling.
Doctor Strange.
Oh, yeah, Doctor
Strange. So no, then.
At the end of the day, people are pissed.
Yeah, word.
Listen,
no, I'm actually
this
very
time I am certain that Benedict Cumberbatch is not Khan, so that's good.
Are you really that certain, Dylan? There is going to be alternate realities in this, so maybe one of those alternate realities is Star Trek Into Darkness.
Or damn. Sherlock.
You're right. And in another alternate continuity, he's a dragon.
Okay. Like we all wish we were.
So let's see.
So what else is going on in the world, Andres, right, that the kids need to know about?
All right, so next up we have, way back in 2010, there was a strategy, a kaiju-based strategy board game called Monsterpocalypse, and it was picked up for a movie with Tim Burton attached to direct it. But the movie was put on hold because the producers thought it was too similar to Pacific Rim, and they wanted to see how Pacific Rim was going to do box office-wise. Well,
I remember David and I talked about this when this was announced. Damn.
Mm-hmm. And now the project has been put back on in the spotlight, as the movie rights for the Monsterpocalypse brand
is now up for bid, and there are four studios that are bidding for the rights to get the movie rights for Monster Apocalypse, which are Sony, Warner Brothers, DreamWorks, and an unnamed fourth studio, with Evil Dead remake director Fed Alvarez attached to it.
So he's already attached to the project?
Yes.
Before they've even picked a studio?
Similar to how when Tim Burton was already attached to Monster Apocalypse back in 6 years ago.
Oh, so he went to the people who own the rights, probably, to develop the pitch.
Right.
And now they're shopping it. Okay, I see.
Yeah, and they already have a writer. I forgot to write
down
the
writer's
name.
God, I go to film school. What's wrong with me? It's late. We gotta end this.
Yeah. And they still want to keep the basic premise of humanity using giant robots to protect themselves against giant robots. I mean, against giant monsters. However,
never
I feel
seen
like,
that one before.
I feel like there's still a chance to differentiate themselves because Monster Apocalypse as a brand has
Let's not pretend like Pacific Rim invented that, by the
way. Right. And besides, Monster Apocalypse, from what I've researched back when I first got into the board game, has so many different factions of giant monsters and robots that is a large, many possibilities for an ongoing series. You've got, like, dinosaurs, which are homage to Godzilla. You have cyber ninjas that are reference to Ultraman. You've got the Martians, a reference to War of the Worlds. Giant space aliens that are homage to Gigan. You've got giant bugs, giant sea monsters, giant Cthulhu monsters. You've got both the self-defense force giant robots, and you've got the shady corporate sell-to-the-highest-bidder giant monster robots. There's so much variety amongst all the different factions that it's easy for Monster Apocalypse to differentiate itself in style and tone and to Pacific Rim. There's a faction that are giant gorillas. Guess who they are? Homages to.
Are they
Mighty
homages
Peking
to Conga?
Man. Nope, Mighty Peking Man.
Of course.
That makes sense. I like that movie. No, I don't.
Dead Shark?
I was going to say Mighty Joe Young, so I was close, you know.
In Mighty Peking Man?
Yeah, wasn't there a scene where they use a giant shark, but it was like a dead corpse of a giant shark that the suit actor was fighting against with?
Oh, no, I think that's Ape.
Yeah.
I haven't seen that movie. There's a movie called Ape Asterix Asterix A, Asterix P, Asterix E, and it's Ape. And it's about a giant ape that knocks a plane down with its bare hands and then sticks the finger up at it.
Yes, that's the one where the monkey flips him off. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's the one where he fights the shark, I think. I didn't know that was an actual dead shark body. I need to review that movie at some point. There's a whole bunch of those weird fucking knockoff movies I have yet to touch that I probably should.
Hashtag Apalooza confirmed.
Yeah.
Apalooza.
That's how you can tell I'm tired. I just agreed to do more work.
Kong, King of the Paloozas.
Oh, God. That's going to be me doing commentaries in every single episode?
Right before this, I was listening to the latest episode of DFOS, and my favorite moment was Bill's reaction to the idea of Gorilla Grodd and Wonder Woman, where you were like, what? Finally!
It's the perfect matchup, right?
Yes,
the same,
of course.
He had the same reaction as the last time on this show when we were talking about Barbara Gordon getting raped, and we were like, yeah!
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 Okay, let's see. Next. Oh, yeah, your guys' thoughts on Monster Apocalypse possibly coming back?
Dylan, do you have an opinion?
No, not really.
I don't really either.
Yay?
I mean, listen, I'm about giant monster stuff in general.
Mm-hmm.
It's good.
It'll be the closest thing to a Pacific Rim sequel we get, probably. So.
All right. Okay.
Steven, I'm very excited about that. I hope that's. I think that has potential to be better than the first one, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Potentially.
Especially with Daredevil's showrunner as director.
Yeah, Steven Knight, definitely. I think that's what I'm saying. Like, that movie might be better than the original.
Oh, yeah. So
maybe not Spectre.
So, moving on. It was recently confirmed by Nintendo that their next console, the codename Nintendo NX, is going to be released in March of 2017, and that as a result of this, they're going to delay their Wii U Zelda to 2017 so that they can release it simultaneously on both the Wii U and the NX, similar to what they did with Zelda Twilight Princess when it was delayed for the GameCube so that it can be released simultaneously on both the GameCube and the Wii.
So they're going to make a version for
Wii U. I thought Twilight Princess also had a version that was on PlayStation, didn't it?
No, it's a Nintendo game.
I know, but I could swear that they...
Zelda is like a first-party Nintendo title, so it's always been on Nintendo, like Mario and Pokemon.
Except for that time they made those weird...
Right, the CDI games. Yeah. Right.
So let me ask, so they're going to put one on the Wii U and one on the NX. Is the NX, it's a handheld console?
No, but there's a lot of like weird like rumors circulating that the controller itself is going to have some weird gimmick, touchscreen gimmick that will allow it to be used as both a portable system and a home console system when the controller is connected to the console. It's very strange.
Okay,
they haven't revealed anything, and what's really weird is that Nintendo is not going to... It seems like Nintendo's not... Excuse me. They're not going to show the NX at this year's E3, which is usually the place where the Xbox...
You would debut
it? Yeah, you would debut it, yeah. All they're going to do is just present one game, and that's going to be the Wii U Zelda. So it's like a lot of people are very skeptical of Nintendo's business decision because... They don't really have any games to announce outside of really not much. They don't really have any real games to come out for the Wii U for the rest of the year. And meanwhile, there's already rumors that they're going to be stopping production on the Wii U very soon once the NX comes out.
I'm not shocked at any of these business decisions given what I've recently learned about Japanese people.
What specific fact?
They don't seem to give a fuck about selling things.
That's true. I agree. Mm-hmm. I agree with all that.
And currently, what's really sad is like looking at the sales for the worldwide sales of the Wii U, where it's like the Wii U came out one whole year before the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One, but currently the Wii U has sold 12.8 million units. Meanwhile, PlayStation has sold 36 million units, and the Xbox One, 18 million units.
Andre, so you're one of the people that believes that Nintendo's going to go the way of Sega?
I honestly not sure. I mean, especially after seeing how popular Nintendo still is in Japan. But sales-wise, looking at it sales-wise, Nintendo's obviously putting a lot of money into marketing the Wii U and selling the Wii U worldwide. So to see the whole world not reacting very well to the Wii U could be a huge problem for Nintendo. Now, Nintendo could simply I mentioned in a previous episode where if Nintendo were to have just focused on the Japanese market, they would be okay. But the fact is they're trying to cater to an entire worldwide brand. I'm not sure if they're able to recover, because so far the Wii U is doing even worse than the GameCube, which up until now was its lowest performing home console.
I feel like they haven't been able to compete since the fucking Nintendo 64. Like, it seems like every new generation of console they just fail again. There was originally a lot of interest in the Wii because of the whole motion control thing.
Yeah.
But over time, it sort of dropped off in a way.
Yeah, I think the Wii initially was extremely popular, right. And so was the GameCube, right. In my opinion. I mean, everybody I knew was like, I want a GameCube. Yeah. Fuck PS2. And I was like, are you guys out of your fucking minds?
Right now, the Wii currently has sold over 101 million units compared to the 12.8 million units that the Wii U has sold.
So, Andres, the thing I was going to say before was, are you concerned that this new Zelda game is going to be, like, the one on the Wii U is fine, and it works, and it's competently made, and then the one on the NX is just a really, really poorly produced port?
Again, it's...
Like, just made to stretch to the new console?
It's going to be very difficult to understand, because we don't know anything. Nothing has been confirmed for the Wii, for the NX. We don't know. We don't have any information outside of these vague rumors about it, and
the thing is, like, I think the NX could be Nintendo's very last chance at gaining a foothold, a stronghold, or gaining a foothold in the video game market, because if they can't recover from the Wii U sales, and they, if they can recover from the NX sales, then it could be the end of Nintendo.
Damn. Well.
Oh.
It's gonna be an interesting news week on SOS when that happens.
Yeah.
Maybe they should have stuck to playing cards.
That's true. They did start out as a playing card company.
How many more news stories do you have left, dude? Because I'm dying.
Just two. One small one and one big one. The small one is that Ghostbusters is now the new Ghostbusters trailer is now the most disliked movie trailer in all of YouTube.
Is that true?
This is news?
Yeah.
Wow. That's crazy.
And there's now people have been saying that, like, Sony is actually trying to censor the criticism towards the Ghostbusters trailer by blocking out all rational comments and instead leaving behind the sexist comments so that they can use sexism as a scapegoat as to why many people are hating on Ghostbusters.
Oh,
sure.
Right. Somebody says, oh, yeah. I don't think this movie looks good. And somebody else is like, you're a sexist. Like,
yeah,
no,
I've been
no,
hearing a lot of that.
No,
I'm like, I'm allowed to not like something because I don't think it looks good.
Right. But this, to say that, we said this before, where in the last time we talked about the Ghostbusters trailer, where we were like, oh, you know, we're not hating this because a lot of people are not hating this because it's women. They have actual complaints and skepticism as to whether or not this is worthy enough of carrying the Ghostbusters name. And we had a comment who was like, actually, even though you're right, there are still people who are acting very sexist towards this, you know, new Ghostbusters movie. And I will say that...
Well, of course!
Yeah. It's the internet. There's always going to be awful people. And yes, there are a lot of awful people out there that are judging
this movie.
So
what, are we supposed to not have our opinion because those people are being mean? So we're supposed to be like, well, we're not sexist, so we're fine with the movie's existence. I mean, I am fine with its existence. It exists. There's nothing I can do about it, but I'm not excited about it. I mean, I'm not interested in the direction they're taking. That trailer is really boring to me.
Doesn't look good. And I mean, maybe I'm wrong.
We could very well be wrong. I mean, I've heard a lot of talk about how it's a really bad trailer and that maybe the movie is better than that trailer makes it look. All I know is that I personally am not interested in the new Ghostbusters, and it has nothing to do with the fact
all
that
I know is that what I have seen so far, it looks like utter dog shit. That's just from what I've seen.
Just because it doesn't look like a funny comedy, it doesn't look like an interesting science fiction film, it doesn't look like an interesting Ghostbusters story, because
it looks like
the first one again.
It doesn't look like it has one iota of the wit of the original. It's just like stereotypical 2016 comedy, from what I can tell.
I feel that. I can agree with that to a certain extent. There were a couple moments that I thought were okay comedy-wise. I don't remember them at all, so maybe that's a testament to that, but I don't know. All I know is that...
The fucking Key and Peele movie looks way funnier.
Which one?
Keanu.
The one with the... Yeah, that's the name.
Oh, God. Yeah, I want to see that. That looks really funny. I'm about that.
Yeah. So I guess moving on to the last movie news is the thing that came out like the day after we recorded SOS, and that was the big reveal of Rita Repulsa for the live action Power Rangers movie.
Oh, I didn't even expect to talk about this tonight.
Oh yeah, yeah. Let's all talk about Diva Talks.
Yeah, let's talk.
Or,
no,
or Green,
let's
Green
talk,
Scorpina.
Yeah, that's what I was
going
to
say.
Yeah,
I got a text. On Facebook, I'm going to send a picture to you where somebody, some genius, photoshopped Rita Repulsa, the new Rita Repulsa, and showed it side by side with Scorpina, and it looks brilliant.
That was my first thought. I was like, it looks a lot more like Scorpina than this.
Yeah,
Rita,
with the whole jagged, pointy edges thing.
I mean, if that's what you want to do, just make it a Lost Galaxy movie. I'd be about that. Maybe we get some Magnum Defender, you know.
And also, she didn't have the staff in the first picture.
Right, but now we've had later on-set pictures that show her with more accurate accurate staff.
The staff.
And it looks great.
The staff looks
great.
But in the photo, I thought Scorpina because of the pose she was making.
Mm-hmm.
Like in Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, when you see like the stock footage of Scorpina's character, and I haven't gotten to her in G-Ranger, but...
Oh my god.
What?
That is like spot on. Wow.
Oh, you sent it on Facebook. Oh, okay.
Yes. And I'm about to send it.
You're not really doing the whole... Yeah, you can't do the whole Skype link thing.
Right. Oh, I just sent it to you now, Bill.
She looks just like Lammy, because I'm a Jew Ranger fan.
Oh, yeah, definitely, with those colors.
I wish she was just... I kind of wish that she was just Scorpina now. Like, just make that the costume, like, with these color changes.
It would be fine, right?
Like,
to be honest...
if you have Lord Zedd in the movie, you don't even have to really have Rita Repulsa.
No, you didn't even have to. You didn't even really have to do Rita. That was I don't know why they didn't just do Zedd. He's more popular anyway. Here's the thing though, if they would have just made the colors the normal Rita Repulsa colors,
brown and black,
I think it'd be totally fine.
Yeah,
yeah.
It wouldn't be great, but it'd be fine.
No, I just wanted to see the hair, not as big as Rita's hair was. I just wanted to see like a miniature version of
like twin ponytails.
Yeah, like the whole it looks kind of like horns,
or maybe just a helmet that had horns, like the Power Slash Rangers.
Like, imagine how much more like Rita she would be if she just had the hair and the correct colors. Like, those two changes, it would be a perfectly fine adaptation for my tastes.
Mm-hmm.
As it is now, it just looks like a generic science fiction movie.
It reminds me of Loki more than anything else. Like, yeah.
What I said in my original post was, it looks like Loki fucked Poison Ivy.
Also, do we even know if we're getting Zedd in the movie?
Not in this one, probably.
And I like...
They'll probably set him up for a sequel, I imagine.
And we recently had, like, more photos that showed her, Rita Repulsa, in a different costume, where it's a lot more, like, trash baggy looking. And I figure, like, this is probably, like, her initial form after she escapes her prison or whatever. I mean, the green form is like, this is my final form, or is it?
Now I have become Rita, the ever-living.
That initial form also looks, nah. Like, that's the thing. I don't want to say this is bad. Like, I don't know. It sounds like that's what you guys are saying.
I'm just saying that it doesn't look
like her.
It doesn't
create enough of a reaction in me to say that it's bad, because I'm just like, it's so generic.
Like when
stereotypical
when Marvel
that
puts out a costume reveal, they like, oh,
that
that's the character.
I'm not gonna say it's bad. I'm just gonna say it doesn't look like the character.
Yeah.
I suppose that's kind of how I feel.
In a way, that could be a positive.
So it resembles it so
little.
It looks like
the way that like the early 2000s X-Men movies used to adapt characters.
Yeah, I agree. I completely agree.
It's very similar to that. Like how they just made Magneto like wear all black and he just had the iconic helmet. And it wasn't until fucking First Class that we got a Magneto who actually looked like Magneto.
That Magneto costume, and I know that Ian McKellen's great, but that first Magneto costume is such balls. It's like a fucking suit.
Yeah.
Like, if you look at it, it looks like a suit. I mean, in the first X-Men movie, I mean.
Yeah, if it wasn't for his stage presence, he wouldn't be able to sell it.
No, but you know what I mean when I say it looks like a suit? Like, it's got that collar on it. And
yeah.
But I will say this. The suit itself is imaginative, and it's brightly colored, which could...
We're talking about Rita Repulsa
Rita, now? Yeah, Rita Repulsa. Which could give us an indication as to the general aesthetic look and feel of the movie itself.
At least we know they're not trying to make it realistic.
You know what else?
Or gritty.
You know what?
I'm not so sold on gritty yet. It looks pretty gritty to me.
You know what else it reminds me of in a much more direct way, probably because of the color? The fucking Willem Dafoe Green Goblin costume.
Yeah, that too. That too. Just no dumb motorcycle.
It's funny because I always thought that costume in that movie looked like it should be a Power Rangers villain, like that.
Yeah,
because like,
the mouth didn't move.
That movie as a child always made me want like, and this was before I knew that Japanese Spider-Man was actually a thing. But it made me as a child want to see like a Power Rangers esque Spider-Man show because just that suit looked like something out of Power Rangers.
Now, what do you think of the idea of, like, perhaps maybe the reason why they look so drastically different from Rita Repulsa is because they want to distance themselves further from Jew Ranger. What do you think of that? If this is the reason why they want to differentiate themselves, they want to make it look so much different from the source material, what are your guys' thoughts on that?
I mean, I imagine
they
want to...
artistic decision.
I imagine they're going to want to differentiate her from the original Rita in any way they possibly can, because it's a terrible, annoying character.
Yeah, but that's why they cast Elizabeth Banks, though, dude. She's going to be playing that... She's going to be chewing so much scenery. Think about it. She's the only actor that they've cast so far who is, like, a known person. Everybody else is unknowns. So, I think that they cast Elizabeth Banks specifically for the reason of come on and just chew scenery for every day you have to shoot. That's all we ask. I think that's why they cast her. And for that, I think that she could potentially be awesome. I'm totally okay with a scene chewing Rita fucking laughing and fucking going around talking about how she has a headache, and I'm totally fine with that as long as it makes sense in the context of the movie. You know what the problem is with that old Power Ranger stuff? It, like, doesn't gel together, you know? Like, yeah. One minute you're watching, like, a fucking after-school, like, PSA about why you should be nice to the local soccer team kid or whatever. And then you're watching a weird, trippy nightmare with a fucking witch telling her she has a headache. Like, it doesn't work. But if it all looks like that, or if it's all meant to go together like that, I don't know. I think it'll work fine. But I don't know. It doesn't inspire a lot of confidence in me for this to be a really clever thing, if you know what I mean. Like, this strikes me as very, like, how can we make Power Rangers look now that people will be okay with? And not fans, but just the general public. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. Kinda, that's my thought.
I kind of wish they would never be able to get away with it because not enough American fans would know what the fuck they were doing. But if they could just, like, borrow the name from Jew Ranger, because Bandora is such a better name than Rita Repulsa. Like, especially for a movie, like, to be cinematic.
Yeah, I don't know. Rita Repulsa strikes me as kind of a Star Wars name.
That's not necessarily a good thing. If there's one downside to the Star Wars franchise is that they have a lot of really stupid names.
I don't know. I'm okay with it.
Like, it's Skywalker.
Skywalker's not that bad, but like
Skywalker's fine. That's a name that could exist in reality. Not
like,
really.
Like Niebnub, that's a name.
I mean, I'm not saying that name's necessarily brilliant, but like Han Solo. Han Solo is not necessarily a great name because it's a little bit fucking overly descriptive of who he is as a person. Very convenient.
Fucking Jabba the Hutt's Twi'lek assistant's name, fucking Bib Fortuna. Like, it's just full of weird fucking names.
I don't know, I'm okay with that. I'm fine that it's... I want it to be weirder, if anything.
Mon Mothma, who just sounds like, as a child, I always associated her with Mothra, because...
I probably would have, had I remembered her name.
I doubt they'll even say Rita Repulsa, though. They'll probably just call her Rita.
But then that's kind of
maybe,
a problem.
Maybe, but then, like...
She's supposed to be a witch, and her name is Rita. Like, that's just a normal name.
That's what I'm thinking.
Didn't like the Saban official Power Rangers Facebook or Twitter said, well, this is the new Rita Repulsa.
You know, I'm saying that's probably her full name, but they'll probably only call her Rita except for like once. It'll be like whenever they say, for like the twice that they say Superman and Man of Steel.
It's like Batman, Superman.
It's like they'll say Rita Repulsa, and it'll be like a big moment because they'll say the whole name.
Yes.
As opposed to every other time, we'll just say Rita.
You guys think in the sequel they should have Isaac Asimov play Ivan Ooze?
Isn't Isaac Asimov dead?
Wait, did I say Isaac Asimov? Fuck.
Yes.
I'm so fucking.
You mean Oscar Isaacs, don't
yes.
you?
Yes. I'm so fucking.
Yes, I'm so about that. We need to wrap this up, by the way.
That is it for shit you may or may not care about with Andres Perez.
The last thing I wanted to say is that...
Yeah, well, let's actually wrap it up. I mean...
The last thing I wanted to say is that it's very nice that we've seen what Rita looks like. I'm more interested in seeing what the Power Ranger suits are.
Yeah, did you guys see the on-set photos that show potentially the morphers?
No, I haven't.
So, there were a bunch of on-set photos that I saw somewhere.
Okay, I skipped over them because I thought, it's just the actors out of costume, whatever.
Well, so what I saw that I thought was the... And again, I didn't see anything that said, these are the morphers, but I thought it was pretty obvious that's what I was looking at. It could also be the communicators, now that I'm thinking about it. There were several multicolored bands on, like, a fucking, like, on, like, some kind of apparatus, and they were all, like, laid out in a row. And it was each of the colors of the Rangers, and then a sixth one that was gray. So I think this movie is probably going to set up the Green Ranger powers, but not have the Green Ranger appear, and they'll save that for Zed in the sequel.
Yeah, maybe it's like I mentioned this before, where like there's this theory where I guess the reason why Rita Repulsa's green is maybe it's in her powers are have some relation to the Green Ranger's power.
That's
maybe
interesting.
Maybe she steals the power from the sixth morpher, and that's why it's gray, because now the green power is missing.
That's possible. That's possible. If those, by the way, if those are the morphers, though, no, I really hope those aren't the morphers, because they're just like bands. There's nothing. They're just multicolored bands. There's nothing to them.
Or maybe she stole her powers from Joel Schumacher movies.
That's how I get all my power. So.
Oh yeah. Yeah, definitely.
Yep. All right. Well, let's wrap this up. This is starting to get to the length of one of our older episodes. So fuck that. Let's wrap this up.
All right.
Does anybody have anything to announce? I got nothing. Just pretty much.
I'm gonna be working.
Keep watching the skies, kids.
I'm gonna be working on a review for Captain America: Winter Soldier, and I'm most likely gonna be doing a collaboration review with one of my newer friends who is a big comic book movie fan and is really big into internet big into internet culture, comedy, the whole. He's a guy who is like, if you were to make a JonTron reference, he would get it. So yeah.
Gotcha.
So luckily,
sounds like a dude I wouldn't murder.
Is he another American?
Out of jealousy.
No, he is from Sweden. He's from Sweden.
Oh, he's Swedish.
Why is that going to prevent me from murdering him? I don't care. I don't care where he's from. I'll kill a Swedish man.
Did he move to Japan to escape the insane feminism that has recently invaded Sweden?
No, he's here for education purposes, like the majority of the foreigners here. I think he might be going for his PhD. I could ask him while we're recording. But anyways, hope you guys will look forward to that.
I'm by the way, tell him I'm not actually planning to murder him. Not that he would ask. I don't know why he would ask, right. But you know.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
I am.
Just I mean, they may have given, Sweden may have given us IKEA, but they did give us what was the band? Europe, right? They did the Final Countdown.
Oh, were they Swiss?
He tells me they're from Swiss. From Sweden.
Oh, wait, no. Swiss.
I believe that.
I fucked up. Swiss people are from Switzerland, not Sweden.
Yes.
That's right.
Oh, wow. That's really confusing. I'm not... Okay, I can't deal with that right now.
All right.
Until next time, everyone, I'm Bill Worcester, a.k.a. Zazubaar.
I'm Super DM64.
And I have been Andres Perez, a.k.a. Kaiju Noir.
And we thank you for joining us for this very late, aggressive, fun-filled,
podcast
tonight. So thank you very much for listening. We hope you enjoyed. We certainly enjoyed doing it.
Aye.
As always, you can like the SOS Network homepage on Facebook to follow all of our shenanigans. We probably should have talked a little bit about Toku Legion tonight at some point, just because things went down on that page that we probably should have.
Yeah,
but that's okay. Let's not do it now. We'll talk about it next time when Dave's here. But yeah, we probably should address that next time. So you can join Toku Legion. That is a thing that you can do. But there's been some shakeups over there. So, you know, if you're not already a member, maybe now is not exactly the time to join. Maybe next week when you hear some of the changes that went down, you can decide whether or not you want to join. But you can do that as well. I'll link it down there if you want to look at it. Certainly. But you can do that as well. You can follow me on Twitter at Bill_Worcester. You can follow me on Facebook if you can track me down. And I probably won't accept it anyway, so... Yeah, you can friend me. I won't accept that, but you can follow me. So, you know, whatever. I can't control that. Like the rest of my life. Anyway. So, thank you very much for watching. Until next time, kids. The science is science.